I need to start the recording again. Something was a bit off there. Okay, so yeah, you click this and then you click download zip and you download to a location. So you see the code thing, the green button there?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, and then you click download zip and it'll ask you where you want to put it.
Cool.
Okay, so one thing though, before we do anything else, we need to make sure we know where our missions folder is. So the missions folder, it would be in C, or I don't know if it's your whatever letter you have as your root, users, your username, documents, and ARM3 other profiles. So actually, try and find your missions folder. One way to maybe help out finding it is let's. I think what we'll do first, actually, is we will save a mission file and then we'll have a look at a structure, like where it goes to. So let's do that first. Okay. So everyone, let me know when you're in the Eden editor or if you want to participate. So like as soon as you get into ARM3, it's editor, and then you can choose a map. I think we'll choose. Let's see if there's anything interesting.
Hey Phoenix, what is the file we need to download? I had a bit of difficulty locating it.
Yeah,
I'm on the GitHub page now.
Yeah, so it's just the code here, and then you download zip. So you click code, and then you download zip.
Do we open Armat to go into that other one?
No, this is just a browser. Oh yes. After you download it, we'll need to find our mission folder. But what we'll do is we'll save a blank mission, and then we'll see where it's just confirm where it actually goes to. So once you've downloaded the file, then you go into Arma and let me know when you're there, and we'll open up Meldon.
No mods or anything.
No. Let's use Xamfp because the main mod line. Light mod line will also be fine, but mod line. Because we're going to be using some tools from that. The Xamfp actually requires main light at least.
Sorry, my almost only is only on its way now, so.
That's fine. Okay, well, so whilst loading, we go to like a main screen, we go to editor, we go to Malden. Malden is kind of smallish, and so we'll just use that. And I'll continue up, load up so long. Okay, and now we're in the game world. And then what I'm going to do first is I'm going to just save it. I'm going to immediately hit save or control S. And then I'll just put in the root missions folder. So you'll see a missions browser here. I'm just gonna call it test mission. And note that any spaces you have here, the file folder name will have an interesting effect. I'll show you just now. So we'll just save. And then I'll just wait for you guys to be ready. So let me know when you guys are there.
Will do.
I saved it.
Done.
Okay. So was test. Okay. So now, in order to find the mission folder, it's a bit hard to see, but let me actually put in a text file here.
Sorry, I'm not there yet.
Is there a way to make your screen full screen?
Is my one too small? What?
I'd love to have it bigger, but can you make your screen full screen on our stuff with Discord?
Yeah, to the right and bottom.
Yeah, better be careful of what control you wish for me to have over your computer.
What about the banking details?
You said we just go to Malden.
Yeah, Malden. Let's do Malden. 2035 Malden.
Okay.
I think hackers will actually deposit money into my account when they see it.
Okay. So once you just go inside it, just save a mission. You can call it whatever, including whatever. Just save it, and then we'll just see where it actually goes to. So my mission folder is located something like this. So it's C, users, Adam's my username, documents, Armor 3, other profiles, because I created a custom Armor 3 profile. And when you go inside there, you'll see this, like a folder you see on the left. So are you able to find that?
I've just saved the mission now.
Yeah, I've got this Madden.
Sorry?
I've got the test file, yeah.
Ah, okay. So anyone not able to actually find your mission folder?
Yeah, I'm still trying to, locate this thing now.
I'm still trying to get into the game.
I saved this thing now, so where did you say you go? You go to documents, Armor 3 other profiles.
Yeah, like I'm showing on my screen, but yeah, Armor 3 other profiles, then that should be inside the mission folder. Let me just check.
Yes. Okay, I've got it.
I don't actually. Yeah, there we go. That's a complete thing. So that's, and then that's your armor. Okay, cool. So.
Got it.
Okay, so it kind of basically looks like that. Okay, so anyone not there? Or I mean, imagine.
Yeah, I'm still trying.
Give me one second.
I'm sure if I'm going to watch this video later that you're recording now, I'm going to bombard you with a lot of questions later, but for now it makes sense. So far. But the directory.
Yeah. Okay, so once we have the file downloaded, okay, so with the zip file, you'll probably see over here on the left, if you open up the zip file, it'll look like something like this. So this XAMPP here is basically all the contents of the zip file. Or there might be a folder called master inside of it. Let me actually, no, I can't actually, it's probably pointless to check. So are you guys able to find a folder that looks like this, that has XAMPP and has like inside it? Oh, I'm on the wrong branch for this. Yeah. Hold on a second. I'm just going to switch branches.
Mine have completely different files in it. Mine only have XAMPP master.
I'm sorry. It is a bit different. I'm on a different branch on the campaign branch. Give me a second. Just quickly go there. Okay, so that's just check out.
If we open XAMPP master, then we've got another XAMPP master, which I think you need to extract in.
In XAMPP master, there's a XAMPP master. If you go in there, it will give you the VSCode test and XAMPP VR. If you go into XAMPP VR, you'll find autopilot
now,
loadout and XAMPP.
Now does it look like what you have? XAMPP VR here.
Yes.
Okay, there we go. So now what you want to do is you want to take, go into XAMPP VR. This is the actual mission file. Everything else is just tooling outside. This basically tells it how to handle with Git and some of this automatic testing of the code every time there's a change. Well, some not like more like linting, but not important. So none of this stuff is anything to do with Armor specifically. And the README file is inside here, which we'll probably go through just now.
Sorry, are you running in Linux or something?
Well, I'm running on Windows, but I'm running Linux inside Windows. Actually, not even right now.
Oh, okay.
This is actually Windows. This terminal, for example, is actually Linux in Windows, WSL.
Oh.
But I'm not going to show you. I was just using a terminal just now to change branches. It's not something you have to worry about. Okay, once you have XAMPP VR, then once you have this thing folder, so is everyone, is anyone not here yet where we have the downloaded thing and you see XAMPP VR?
Yeah, I can't find it.
Okay, I've got that.
So do you have the downloaded file?
I think so.
And if you go inside the file, you go to, I think, master, and then you see something that looks like this, where you have README and PyProject and this and that, and inside they have Xamarin.vr.
You see, I don't have, there's some of the stuff that I don't have, but it's cool.
As long as you see Xamarin.vr.
Yeah.
It'll be in your downloaded folder,
Eagle. Yeah, if you downloaded it, so this thing that we downloaded over here, code, and then we downloaded it with zip. It basically is all the stuff.
It wants me to buy stuff. I don't have OneZip.
Oh.
Download Zip 7 or what? 7-Zip, yeah.
Wait, does Windows not have a built-in Zip thing?
Windows does it automatically.
I can open the thing. It's if I open it, it says VS Code test Xamf.
Yeah, excellent. So Xamf VR, that's the file we're going to want.
Okay.
Okay, so I don't extract it into the missions folder.
Yeah, so don't extract. So what we're going to do, we're going to copy-paste certain things. So what we want to do is copy-paste everything except mission.sqm. So if we go here, there we go. So select everything except mission.sqm. Right-click, copy, and then I'm going to go into my testing mission, which is this one over here. I'm just going to paste. There we go.
Okay, so you just copy everything in there then?
Yeah, just copy everything inside Xamarin VR. So you don't everything inside Xamarin VR itself, nothing outside of it.
Yes.
Yeah, so the only contents of Xamarin VR, this folder. You want to copy all of this except for the mission.sqm.
Yes, and that you copy just in that test mission folder. So it's not going to lie on the same hierarchy than Xamarin Master.
Yeah.
Or do you copy it into Xamarin Master?
Yeah, well, actually, the best way to look at where mission.sqm is inside Xamarin VR.
Oh, here it is, yeah.
Yeah, and so basically you want to put in the same level as a mission.sqm in your mission. So like you'll have a mark with SQF next to your mission.sqm, for example.
Okay, so, sorry, Phoenix. Those stuff I've selected now from that folder, must I copy that to the folder where test mission is in?
Yeah. So copy all the contents of Xamarin.vr except for mission.sqm, so you shouldn't have to overwrite anything.
Okay, I've got it.
Yeah, so now your mission folder should look like this. Pre-init, Orbats, H-mission, HP, SQM, markers, SQF, and whatever. And you have three folders, autopilot, loadout, and Xamarin. Okay.
Yeah.
So when you create a mission, so maybe I should briefly explain, but when you created the mission, the only thing that is created is this like a folder, and this folder represents the file name that when you export this, it will actually be your mission's file name. And then this is going to be and then the mission.sqm is the only thing that's normally created. Everything else is just like user extra scripts and stuff, but there's normally nothing, only mission.sqm and nothing else. So if you just use a manila editor and nothing else. Okay, so now once we've done that, so everyone's done that?
Yes.
Okay. What we want to do is we want to now copy the actual slots and units and everything from the template. So to do that, let's also let me actually copy xamf.vr or the whole xamf folder. What you can do is you can actually extract the contents of the xamf or just the xamf vr into your missions folder itself. Not the test mission, but everything. It's just like another mission.
So in the main folder of missions.
Yeah, in the main missions folder, yeah. So not inside your test mission, but inside here. So like mine over here. This is Xamf with all the code. It's inside as if it's another mission.
So the whole Xamf, not the Xamf VR only.
Xamf VR is fine as well. You don't need the rest, so you're fine with Xamf VR.
Okay, and that we put in mission folder.
Yeah, into the actual missions folder. So this actual folder, not any missions inside of it.
So in the mission folder, okay. It will be the test mission and Zamfiar now.
Yeah, yeah. So then, you might just have Zamfiar and test mission only inside your missions folder. Cool. So everyone sorted. That's what's wrong.
Yes, I can't find my test mission that I
have. Okay, but we're not putting it inside the test mission itself.
No, I know. It's just my test mission is gone.
Are you sure? Are you inside the missions folder itself?
Yeah, it is in your. Normally, it goes to your documents into.
Okay, well, just put your the Zamf inside there, and then if we lost it, it's no big deal. We'll redo that step. Okay, so once you copy it inside there, you go into the mission editor and you open, Control O, some shortcut. I'm sure there's another button up there, top left, and then now you should see the Zamf in virtual reality. My one's inside a subfolder called Zamf, and I see it over here, but your one might be just in the main list on the right, but you should be able to see it's the same folder structure you have in your file explorer. You guys see the Zamf now here, this virtual reality?
Yep.
Okay, anyone not see that?
No, mine is not there yet.
It's not going to auto appear. You have to cancel and open up again if you've copied it and that window was open.
Yeah.
Okay,
let me just double check. Okay, so there should be a mission called Zamf.
Yeah. It's either in the missions folder, or if you exported the parent directory, then it'll be inside a parent directory called Zamf. Like, I have the whole thing, like, all the other stuff in the Zamf folder.
I accidentally did the Zamf master. Is that okay, or must I just do the Zamf VR?
It doesn't matter.
Okay.
You just...
Sorry, how do you get this folder that you're working on now? I was busy with...
Open, top left, or control.
Okay.
O. And you go to Zamf, and you should see the Zamf.
Did we open that?
Yeah, then once you're there, you just open it. Okay, so everyone's sorted.
No, yeah. I only see missions.
Yeah.
Sorted.
Okay, so if you in the missions folder here, these are all the mission files folders in the root of your missions directory in a user folder. If you put the Zamf inside a subdirectory, then you'll see it on the left as like subdirectories, and you'll see the mission appear over there.
Okay.
Just make sure you extract the Zamf. It doesn't matter if it's the parent Zamf or the Zamf VR folder, but you don't want to extract the contents of Zamf VR into your missions folder. You want to make sure you have the Zamf VR folder in there. So, this lowest level you want to do, just copy the Zamf VR folder inside. Let me just. Can I do that?
Ducks. If I double click on, you see mine in my mission editor of my hidden editor, it doesn't give me that same view that you had now. Mine doesn't have that nice little drop down on your left hand side like yours have there.
Well, maybe because you don't have any subdirectories, that's why.
I mean, I do. So what I did is, it's just a bit slow. So it shows you, you're in your open screen there, where your mouse is now, in that window there, in that text area there. It will bring up my missions that I have. So if I click on missions, they're on your mission tree on your left-hand side. If I click on missions, it doesn't give me the subdirectories like you've got there now. It's only in that screen there where your mouse is now, in that text window, it will show test mission and Zamf.
Okay, so go into Zamf, and then you'll see Zamf from the main thing you open.
Yeah, you see, I got, if I double click on it, it opens up that mission.
Which mission? Zamf.
The Zamf, yeah.
Okay, well, I mean, that's what we want. We want to go into Zamf. So.
Okay.
Okay, so is anyone not in the Zamf mission here, this template here?
Interesting enough. Yes, okay, I'm there. iets reg gekry, hulle.
Okay, so as I who is having an issue still?
Yeah, it's Igor. I can't. It's in my folder. In my test mission folder, but in Arma, I don't see it.
Oh no! You don't put it in your test mission itself. Put it.
No,
in
no.
Your, sorry.
In the missions folder where my test mission is.
Ah yes.
That is where XAMPP is. But how do you export it?
No, it should already be in the correct format. Sorry, is a folder inside your missions folder, is it XAMPP.vr, or is it just a XAMPP folder with a XAMPP VR inside it?
XAMPP. Only XAMPP.
Okay, when you go inside XAMPP, do you see XAMPP.vr inside it?
No.
Oh, so I think you might have copied the contents of the mission folder into the missions folder. So, I think what you want to do... go to where you see XAMPP.vr, the parent directory where you download it, and just copy that into your missions folder.
Okay, give me a sec.
Save your time with all your elements and all your entry boxes already all lined up. So you're basically just going to use this and copy it in each and every mission that you create, right?
Yeah, this is like a base. And then all you technically all you have to do is decorate the base and put some enemies in. We're technically done. Of course,
it gets okay, got it.
Excellent. Okay, so we're all there. So then you should be able to open it inside. So what we're going to do, now we're going to copy these into our own mission that we just made. So the safest way to copy, actually, because there's one special thing, this... respawn this marker called a respawn west. So the stuff like this looks like a marker. This stuff is important because this literally tells you where you respawn. If you don't have it, then you respawn exactly where you die. So you probably, some of you have experienced that in like two weeks ago. So it wants to make sure we copy all the markers. So when you're in the 3D view, you can't see markers, and so you can't copy them. So the safest way to copy everything, including markers, is to go to the map, as you press M, and then make sure you're in marker mode so you can see the marker. Actually, even without being marker mode, you can see the markers. And then you just select everything up here. And then you just Control-C. Actually, Control-C like three times because sometimes it doesn't pick it up. And then once you do that, you open, you go to your test mission, open. Those okay, it's unsafe changes. And then you go to where you want people to spawn. I think I'm just gonna have people spawn inside a military base. It looks fine inside here. Just gonna zoom in and just control V, paste the guy. Just double check that the markers there. Yeah, it is. So everything.
Where did you find that military base now?
Well, that's just in the southeast. You can choose anywhere you like as a starting base. I think maybe we won't make all exactly the same mission. You guys can pick your own location, but. For me, I have a starting base over here.
Sorry, what's the quickest way of bringing your camera there? Because if you're in the map view...
Yes, so middle mouse button.
This is going to make my life easier. Yes, see. You told me this earlier. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So we did a couple of steps. So anyone not have all our XAMPP slots in the base yet?
I'm going there now.
Okay. And in the meantime, what we can do is just move stuff around, because right now, if we were to start the mission, some stuff might blow up, like some vehicles inside buildings and stuff. So, and crates will fly into the sky as soon as we spawn. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take like some vehicles and just move them around. Well, actually, once we all do that, I actually need to backtrack for a second and just show you what's in the XAMPP thing. So I'll actually do that. But first, we will... first of all, make sure that everyone's up to speed here.
So, something.
I just want to double check. I kind of, in the VR area, I copied.
Yeah, make sure you're map mode, press M so you can see the markers. Like there'll be one little marker, like a purple circle dotted line next to the slots. Make sure you're cop selecting that as well when you select everything.
from your paste and something's overlaying something else, you just move it around.
Yeah, just move it around, it's fine.
Cool.
Okay, so Igor, you sorted?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm gonna go back to the Zamp VR. You don't have to go there with me because you never have to go back to the Zamp VR. But I just want to explain what everything is in the Zamp itself in the 3D view. So I'm gonna just control save, and I'm going to just I'm just gonna go to the Zamp view. Okay, so as you guys noticed, these are obviously all the slots. This is actually, if you hover over, you can kind of see what team they are. Like, this is one FTL. This is what you see in the roles. Like, everything to the right of the at is actually the group name, and then all that stuff. So I'll go into explaining the init just now. So yeah, these are the slots. Here's Dragon 0, Dragon 1, Dragon 2, Dragon 3, Dragon 4, Dragon 5, Ghost Rider, and the two Badgers and the pilot. So you guys should all be familiar with these crates. These are the group crates locked specifically to certain units. The way it's locked, it just calls a function. So I think I'll just briefly explain it, just bits and pieces. Like if you were to double click on something, then you'll see an init field. This is a code that's initialized on for each person on mission start. So actually, one scripting thing, if you do put script inside here, note that every time like someone joins a server, this will be executed for everyone. So inside the script, there's actually protections to prevent from double execution, whatever. So just that's how it works. So this executes for everyone once. If 10 people join start the mission, then it'll be executed 10 times for everyone. So it's like 10 times 10. So you have to be careful with that. So sometimes, normally scripts, commands that only affect one unit is put over here, for example, then it doesn't really matter. So like this calls a Zamf function create. You don't have to know any of this or do that, but I'm just explaining, and it tells you that it's limited, like it's assault squad loadout, it's limited to Dragon 1 only, and this allows you to save kit, and that basically calls a function. And yeah.
So that, sorry, that true function, when you with your mouse wheel scroll down on that, it tells you save loadout. Is it that true that you've got in there, or is that a different piece of script somewhere so that you can save your loadout?
Sorry,
in the mission now, you said that's what allows you to save your loadout. That's true. Yeah. Is that little true word there? Is that the script that tells you can scroll with your mouse wheel and say save loadout?
Yeah, so basic calls is this is the return value. This is null, which means nothing. I'm not expecting anything. So this is a return value for a function. This thing at the end is the actual function name I'm calling. So that this basically contains the code. It's like basically the code. Call tells it to actually execute this function. There's different ways of calling this. Calling, the sporting, not too important. And then these are the parameters. So you give it. So you tell you execute this function. You say, hey, yes. I can execute you with these options. So I'm going to say first parameter is the crate. Second parameter is going to be the type of loadout. So it has to be set number of a correct loadout that it already knows about. Dragon 1 is a group name, and then true. So I mean, it's not important, but I think I'll just show you so you guys know. So loadout, is it crates? Yeah. So this is the function that's actually calling crates, and you can see it's crate loadout, and then option is it option? Let me see if it's actually executing this. Crate that, and it should be. Or refill. Oh, actually, it's something else. Hold on. Sorry. This is being called by something else. Functions. Crate. Ah, there we go. This is a function, and then that calls that other script. So it's actually like been nested. So you have a crate, gear, name, restrict. Normally, so a properly documented function, you'll see like a doc string at the top, which explains how it works, what the first parameter is, second parameter, third parameter, like this fourth parameter, which is, they start counting from zero, so it's actually number three, but it's the fourth in the list. If true, then restrict access to members of the teams whose group ID matches the name, which is this name here. So yeah, so that's so we're not doing a scripting tutorial here. So if this went over your head, doesn't matter. It won't affect the rest of the tutorial. Okay.
Thank goodness.
It's just good to know. No, it's just good to know where it's coming from.
Yeah, a little bit background.
Yeah,
a little background. Yeah. So, just to show you a bit more, so I'm gonna click on a unit. I'm just gonna show you what the box in general. You click on something. This is basically all the properties for the unit. Object type. You can change what type of unit it is. For these Zamf guys, it doesn't matter what type of soldier they are, because the script over here, another init, will actually change the kit. So, you know, it doesn't really matter. It deletes everything and applies everything. So this list over here, where you can change the type of unit, is exactly the same as the list you get on the right, where you can just select whatever you want. The only difference is that this one puts a new one down, and if you double click inside here, it changes it to the existing one. And then init, and let me go to an existing unit so you can see what they often have. And then this init, so this variable name, only if you're doing scripting, you just give it a name so that you can refer to. Important init is the initialization code, like I explained. And then this stuff, you actually don't have to do much with this, because like transformation, the position, rotation, placement radius, like actually placement radius is different, but position, rotation, it's literally just that's position. There we go. That's the first one. There's literally no reason for you to manually put anything inside there. And then rotation, like. There's rotation.
Just a quick question. The position. Just go back to position on that.
Hold on a second. I do some funky stuff so you can see some other stuff. So you can. So on the top left, you can actually see various tools like select. So select is just moving around. Translation, when you drag this, it just moves them back and forth, this and that. And then rotation widget is just for rotating, so you can do some weird things.
User entered your channel.
And then area scaling widget is not going to work here, because it's only if you want to have like a box that you want to make bigger and smaller. Area widget is the same. So those two doesn't apply to individual units. And then there's toggle translation grid. So it now moves smoothly, but you can make them move in a grid. Like you can make them move on an imaginary grid that's 1 meter. So now if I turn that on, it'll only move 1 meter increments. Or if I make it like 8, I can drag and then only moves every 8 meters in the imaginary grid. So that's how you get, I got like all these guys in a perfect grid by using this translation grid. And then rotation grid is the same thing, but it's just 4 degrees. So if I want to rotate someone, I can only rotate it like every 15 or like 90 degrees. This is good if you like putting buildings together and you like want walls to only be 90 degrees from each other, nice square, then this is a handy thing to do.
Rotation.
Yeah. Okay, so these are minor things that you guys will pick up just by looking at the toolbar, but I'm just briefly going over. Okay, now go back to what you were asking about inside.
The position of your element, that's zero at your Z level. Is that above sea level, or is that, if that's zero, is that on the ground? Because if you have a big building and you put it at an angle, let's say there's a slope, that's zero. Does it mean it's on the, it's flat on the ground at that slope, or does it mean it?
So
you understand what I'm saying? If you put elements down and you just want to make sure it's on the ground, that when you start the mission, it doesn't fall a bit, or it spawns in the ground, you know, that kind of thing. And your ground is not 100% level.
Just make it zero.
Okay.
So, I mean, so hold on. So you can see this is above ground level. If we put it on top of water, you'll see the Z is 159. So now it's above the ground on the sea floor. So it's whatever ground it is above.
There's a snap to ground.
Yeah. So okay. We'll go over that just now, because those are also useful things. So let me place down a building.
It's just something that I struggled. Yeah, it's something that I struggled with last time when I built a mission. Is when you put elements down to make sure it's, you know, flat on the surface.
Yeah. So this is, also above ground level. Okay. So in order to put something flat, so there's two things. These are two important things. Actually, I never use this one. Is toggle vertical mode and toggle snapping surface. So Actually, the first thing is maybe with building is useful. So now, if I was to move a building, I can move it in the ground, out the ground, doesn't matter.
Yes, it
completely free floats. It ignores the terrain. The first option, toggle vertical mode. If you do this, then actually, let me just see if it works with the building now. Oh yes, I think vertical mode. Hold on, maybe let me just check if the vehicle actually might be. Just remove rotations. Okay, there we go. So let me use vehicle better, not snapping the building. So if you have vertical mode disabled, you know, free float like I showed. If you toggle vertical mode and you go here, then it'll be vertical relative to the ground.
Okay.
So that's probably one thing you want.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Let me select the translation widgets just so you can see the behavior. But it's still free floats. I can make it sink into the ground, and then when it spawns, it'll blow up. So then the next thing you could do, you can then toggle surface snapping. Now it'll actually detect a surface is on, and it'll snap into position. One area where surface snapping is quite useful is if you want to place infantry. So for example, if I have surface snapping off, let me just do this. Then I have no idea if it's on the person on the building.
Yes.
If you turn surface snapping on, now it'll just snap on the roof.
Okay.
So the same thing works with a table. So I can like take this table. I can now snap it on the roof. Let's say I want a water bottle. Let me take a water bottle, and I want this water bottle to snap on the table. So thanks to snapping, it was quite easy to put a building down, put a table on top of the building, and put a water bottle on top of the table. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all that stuff over there. Okay, so continuing on to the ZAMF. The crates behind each group belong to the group. So ground zero is over here, and you know the group crates. If you want, if your mission is never going to need a fixed wing pilot, what you can do, you can literally just drag and just delete this crate and the guy. So if you want to delete badger, just select drag and then delete the crates and that. So this over here, equipment crate. This is you should be familiar with the equipment. Now, if you go inside, normally if you go inside a crate and you go to equipment storage, you won't see the actual equipment it has. Because what it does, the script actually deletes it and applies the kit that's in the ZAMF because of this script command inside here. So that's, unfortunately, if you want to see, I mean, I'm actually going to be changing this in the future, how it works. But just to see what it looks like, it'll, like this equipment crate over here, the script command, you put in a parameter equipment inside here, and basically it looks for equipment over here. There you go, equipment right at the top, equipment, and it loads up this stuff. It's basically a script command for cable ties, 100 cable ties, 6 wire cutters, 100 empty sandbags, entrenching tools, 10 of them, this and that, whatever. So basically it applies this stuff after it deletes everything. You don't have to know the scripts. If you want to have your own custom crate, and you just go to the crate, make sure there's nothing in it. If you place a fresh crate down, it's fine. And inside here, you can just modify, put whatever you want. You can clear it. And you can put, let's say I want some mines done. And then it'll have that stuff and nothing else. So if you want to control over, if you want to put down your own crates or whatever. In the future, I'm going to make the ZAMF a bit different, where the ZAMF actually modifies the mission SQM, and then all the our kit actually appears on the list over here, and then you can modify it. So that's what I'm going to do in the future. But for now, it's just a script that modifies it on mission start. Okay, go ahead.
Sorry, man, over there by the crate, you just copy and paste that crate, right?
I just Control-C, Control-Z. Control-C, Control-V.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, so mostly stuff will work, like Control O for opening, Control S for saving, Control C, Control V.
Yeah.
So most of the stuff should be fine. Control Z for undoing, so I can undo the stuff I did. So I can undo, redo works most of the time. That's 95% of the time it works great. Okay, so other crates we have. Explosives crate, familiar with. Paradrop crate. So this is kind of like an optional crate. It could be safely be deleted. Now, these ones are the real optional crates. So sometimes mission makers might want to remove them because it might be too powerful or maybe not nice. So surveillance, this one has the UAV inside. It's actually to see what's inside of the good. Surveillance. So it has one UAV backpack, batteries, Hunt IR monitors, and Hunt IR rounds. inside the surveillance crate. So like, if you don't want UAVs in the mission, you can just delete that. Suppressors, if you don't want suppressors, you just delete that. Arsenal crate, normally we do is go and hide it, and then Zulu-Alpha plays a famous game, like a very popular game of Easter Egg Hunt Arsenal Crate Edition. So that's that stuff. Then,
sorry, you ahead? Sorry, Phoenix, how do you access the code? What do you press?
You can open with Notepad or Notepad++. So what I like to use is VS Code. I won't go too much into it, but I'll just say that you can VS Code is free. It's very lightweight, and then you get the SQF extension. SQF language. That should be fine. Yeah, SQF language and SQF lint, I suppose, as well. Why are they different versions? Maybe I should. No. Never mind. Yeah, and then what you'll find it inside your missions folder. So like, there's a testing mission. If you go in test mission, you're going to loadout. That's where the mission folder is. Mm-hmm. You're going to loadout. You'll see crates. You can open this in with Notepad, for example, Notepad plus or whatever coding you want.
Okay.
You'll see. Yeah. So the loadouts are on their own folder. There's gear. This basically tells people how they kit up. Like grunt, for example. Let's see. This guy is a grunt. So then this grunt will actually load up all the kit inside here. You can actually generate this code automatically with using the Arsenal. Not the Ace Arsenal, but the vanilla Arsenal. You can click export and then you can paste code inside here and it'll actually work. But okay. People don't really need to do that. I think people like to go inside the. Where is it? Oh yeah, it's not inside. Yeah. So if you do want to modify a guy, obviously the init now the init will kind of break the group stuff. So you probably shouldn't modify the starting kit of a XAMPP slot, because this code also does other things like ties you to the crate and stuff. But I mean, it should be fine if you don't need crates, then it's probably fine. So what you do is you go to edit loadout, Ace Arsenal or BI Virtual Arsenal. So you go any guy, you right click, Ace Arsenal is better, and then you can just customize over there, put whatever you want, apply, and your guy should have that applied. And then that'll be that in your mission itself. So this is good for like AI. Maybe you want a VIP and you want to make him look a certain way. You can just do that, and it'll be persistent. There are some exceptions. So some factions have their own script, which messes with it. But I think if you have issues like that, then we can deal with that. I'm not going to cover every edge case now. So yeah, disable CFP randomization might be something you might have to do, because it's the community factions project that sometimes messes with a kit on spawn because it wants to randomize with their own script. Okay.
Just a quick question again on that script. Would Notepad also work? The normal Notepad?
Yeah, you can literally use anything to modify the code. I mean, I wouldn't want to go through like hundreds of lines of code without it being nice to, you know, like correctly color linted and being able to have all sorts of, you know, useful things. I could hide sections and make it smaller, so and all that stuff. So yeah, but if a code editor I recommend is VS Code. It starts off with almost no extensions. It's very simple, very fast, very lightweight, and you only add the extensions you actually want to deal with. So if you only want to do SQF like ARMA stuff, you just do SQF, and you know, you install that extension. You just go to extensions, select your extension, use like search. Hey, I want that one. You install it, and now it understands ARMA language. So it's very nice.
Cool.
Okay. All right, so back to the slots. We went through all the crates in the slots. Now, these guys over here in the corner, these are the spectator slots. So I normally always keep them. Nobody uses them. They don't cause an issue. But if you want, you can delete them. Doesn't matter. These are the own init stuff inside here. Just delete them if you want. Now, these things you want to keep, and the headless clients. So you don't touch them because this allows the headless clients to join. And then this one allows the logged in admin to Zeus the mission. So this is a special thing over here. Actually, there's a special function that I need to make it more reliable, because otherwise it's unreliable. So normally these guys in the corner, I just put them in a corner somewhere near the spawn and just leave them alone. So forget about them. This stuff up here, this is just like some basic alive configuration. You can just leave them alone. Don't have to worry about that. Just put it somewhere, leave them alone. Now, these are your resupply crates. So you want to put your resupply crates somewhere that's accessible to your vehicles or whatnot, or you can remove them if you want. Here is UGV Stomper optional. Normally, delete them. And this is a repair truck. repair truck, and then, oh yes, and then there was a medical thing. Now, as one note, these vehicles are actually already pre-configured. Like Hemet, for example, it actually has the contents of a medical resupply crate in it, and this one might have some settings. Yeah, it has some repair crate settings or whatever. So if you want to modify these to something else, let's say you want to make some medical Humvee, then it's best to double click and then you go to the object type like we saw earlier, and then I'll just search for medical Humvee. Okay, so let me do which one? Let's do US Army. Let me just make it ambulance. What they call them? Ambulance. There we go. It's all the factions. Let me go to US Army ambulance. Okay, there we go. Now it's an ambulance. And it has all the settings that we had before and all that stuff, so we know what it is. I mean, it behaves the same as expected from the XAMP. So generally, if you want to modify a vehicle that's in the XAMP, it's best, safest to just modify it, the existing one, rather than place a new one. Okay, and that's pretty much everything. So in terms of the XAMP itself, I'll do one of the other things. Orbat was just something where you can look at, see the structure of ZA. It's not dynamic, it's static, and like it's not important. I usually just delete them because it's just annoying. I should probably remove them from the XAMP. This field hospital marker, you don't actually, it's nothing special. You can delete it if you want. It's just a thing. This hospital building is a special building. It has, the only thing special about it is medical facilities ticked here in ACE options. That means when you go inside it, you get like the full heal and all that stuff. Yeah, that's pretty much it. So anyone have any questions?
What do you do if you want to say add helicopters or another vehicles or stuff like that?
Yeah, so that's in your mission itself. So in terms of the XAMPP, so I'm assuming we're all sort of the XAMPPs. Now let's go back to the mission and we'll start adding stuff like that.
Okay.
So let's go to Malden. No, not new. Control. Oh, not Control A. Test mission. Okay, so in here, I did some stuff. I kept all the slots here. I have the resupply crates in the. I'll put my resupply crates over here. That way, if we have a chopper, it's relatively easily accessible for vehicles. It's easily accessible. And medical section the side over here. Realistically, medical stuff should be close to the helipad. That's close enough. And yeah, you guys spawn outside the barracks buildings, which makes sense. You wake up.
User in your channel timed out.
And you go to your stuff. Yeah. Okay. And then here, arsenal crate. We always go and hide it there somewhere. There we go. Let's put it inside the building. And then these crates are optional. Let's keep surveillance and suppressors. It's fine. So we're gonna keep it over here. And there we go. And that's basically a spawn area setup. I just double check that I have my respawn markers there. Field hospital marker. I'm going to delete the field hospital marker because military base is a, everyone knows something inside military base. I'm going to delete these Orbats things because they're not useful. You don't have to delete them, but it's fine. Okay, so I've got everything set up. Oh yes, helipad. Are you going to delete the helipad that comes with the XAMPP because we have a helipad already? Yeah, and that's everything. Okay, so that's basically my base setup. Okay, so now if you want to place something down, basic editor thing, you go to Bluefor, the faction that's part of. And let's say you want to put a Black Hawk down. I like to get them from the U.S. Army Rangers thing. Let's choose a DAP for pylons. And now if you click, then you can every time you click on the map and it appears over there. But it has AI inside of it. So if you want to place down an empty vehicle, you click on it and then you hold down Alt and you'll see the icon, the helicopter icon is kind of small for you. It will appear yellow. Yellow means empty. Yeah. You click and now it's empty.
Oh.
And now that's basically all you do, and now you have a vehicle to work with. Okay, so I'm just gonna have a helicopter. This is more like an airborne thing. I'm gonna put on the side and
sorry, Phoenix.
Yeah, go ahead.
Your sound went away. Just say again the empty helicopter, how you do it?
Alt.
Oh, yeah, hold on, Alt. So I'm gonna place down three choppers. I'm gonna place down a little bird for a gunship one for some support, and I gotta basically have a backup normal little bird. Where is it? Which is actually Melb. There we go. Melb. I'm gonna hold down Alt, click. There we go. Nice thing about little birds is that normally if you want to like put, you're not going to put a black hawk in the corner somewhere over here, but a little bird is like, oh, that's so much space, thank you. Like how small these guys are, like if you put them underneath the other chopper.
Yeah, if that black bird takes off, it's going to blow the little birds off.
Yeah, well, I mean, in armor, yeah, probably not, but yeah, in real life.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so now we have that. So that's basically the blue fall done, I would say. I mean, of course, you can spend some time doing stuff. So let me just show you how to get some like some props. So I won't show all the props, but props on the far right. These are actually, what are these? Oh no, these are not. That's not what I want. Sorry, compositions, not props. Compositions. On the top right, you go custom, and these are things it's probably empty for you now, but if you subscribe to compositions on the Steam Workshop, they appear over here. So I have some like assorted pieces, some error message because not all of them are there. And for missions, sometimes I might put these inside buildings, whatnot.
Where do we get that? You say ours will be
Steam
empty.
Workshop compositions, the Armor Steam Workshop.
Okay.
Yeah. So, like, I just got to place down one enemy bunker. Actually, let me just see if there's... I think I'll make... I was thinking of what to make a mission objective. I think I'll just have it a raid on an airbase. There we go. So, inside here, I one of my compositions is a bunker. So, I'm just going to place a bunker down. Oh, this is a camp. Never mind. So, we'll have an enemy camp in a nearby forest. There we go. Yeah, they're camping out in the forest next to the base for some reason. Maybe they're not maybe not popular. They're told to go live in the wood nearby and protect us. Okay, now compositions that are more readily available. If you go to compositions, just go to props inside the compositions, then you'll see a whole bunch available as part of vanilla and mods. So let's say cup. I'm going to do cup military. Desert, field HQ, something small. HQ small, and then I'll just pick, let's say, M113 tower, and I can drop it over here. There we go. There's a mini little base down for you already over here already. So you can do some fairly, I think, large things. Let's see what this looks like. There we go. Here's empty spots over here. Place it over here, and you can actually then that's your starting base over here if you want. So then you have a base. One thing I recommend to improve performance is you select everything except for anything with doors, like this tower. And we actually right-click attributes and then special states, enable simulation is unticked. So the reason for this, and when I do that, you'll see this. So the reason for this is that if you have lots of objects in the mission, it'll have to slow it down, because the server will be constantly communicating its position, will occasionally for some reason. So disabling simulation, like again, like you just click on anything and then you can enable simulation, tick untick. Having it disabled means that this thing will never change. So doors and the building won't open, so that's how it's best to have buildings enabled. Ladders should still work, I think. And it then improves performance a bit. So this is just more of a performance optimization tip.
Phoenix?
Yeah?
Another guy I used to watch on YouTube, Luton, he used to remove it from Zeus. How do you do that?
So we have a script that adds everything to Zeus, but I don't think that causes any issues. It doesn't add all the objects like buildings and stuff. It only adds units. So by default, nothing is in Zeus. Only stuff you place down in Zeus is available in Zeus by default.
Yeah. What I mean is he used to also build missions. See like that base there in front of you. Yeah. I can't remember exactly how it does it, but he selects it and he removes it from Zeus. So it doesn't... It basically brings the whole base into the game. It doesn't run from his PC. So it also speeds up the whole process.
Yeah, we're talking about Zeus, but we're not using Zeus. This is Eden Editor, so...
Yeah, but... I'll go and check out check the videos and come back to you on that one.
Sorry, just a quick explanation. What is Zeus exactly? Eden Editor is where you build the missions, got that. But Zeus exactly, what does it do? What is it exactly?
So it allows you to manipulate a running mission. So Zeus is for mission that's busy running, and Eden Editor is for before it runs, like when you're building it.
Okay.
I'm just going to show you just now. I'm just going to do one quick thing. So just like enable simulation, there's also simple objects. So you want to enable simple objects, and explains like this. So basically it makes also helps with load. So I often do both. Disable simulation, so enable simulation untick, simple object ticked. That this makes you maximize the performance. If this like the minimizes the load this has. So what I'm going to do, now, by default, if you were to preview a mission, you actually preview as the player. So just one thing I'll probably show you. There's three states you can have. There we go. You can have player, playable, playable, or none of them. If it's none of them, then it's like this. So the only difference in multiplayer, really, actually there's no difference in multiplayer. In single player, player is the one you, if you click preview, it's the one you select by default. So I'll spawn this invisible guy by default. So
okay.
If you want to preview as someone else, let's say a Zeta guy, the easiest way is to just right click and say play as character. So I'm gonna do that now quickly.
Yes.
And I'll just show you the difference between Eden and Zeus.
Hold fire. Zeus, that Zeus button that you've put in, it doesn't call out another script. It's purely a script for a mission. If I had to copy that in a completely different mission, it would still work. That Zeus button that you've put in.
You mean the Zeus, the Zeus that module? Marker.
Yes.
Oh, okay, so it won't work. So first of all, this is Zeus. You can see it's different from Eden Editor. I'll go back and talk about the thing just now. So yeah, this is a bit different. So by default of Zeus, none of the things you place in the editor is actually selectable, but we have a script which makes everything selectable. Buildings and stuff is not selectable. This runs in the mission file, this doesn't have a load for a player there. So that's basically it. You can see nothing exploded. I'm surprised. I wonder how this thing will... So things you can do, if you have like AI, you happen to have AI, even if you place this guy down, you can go to modules, remote control, if you want, controlling you do. Let me go to driver seat, let me see what happens. Ouch. There we go. So that's a major damage. So, little things like that make sense testing. Did it actually crash the tires? That's interesting. Hold on, let me check, this will be very interesting. Yeah, so I think it actually simulated Newton's third law, like opposite equal reaction. So when you push against the ceiling, the tires suffer. Okay, so let's go back to Eden Editor. So the question was,
Function over here, this one. Yes.
So this game master has one special function. So if you place it down. There's two differences, two special things that Xamfft does. One, it's this function called Xamfft function Zeus ensure logged in admin. So what this does is always, what you can do is you can put the owner, actually normally what you do is you put owner, you put in hashtag admin logged, and anyone who's logged in will be the Zeus, the owner of the Zeus module can use Zeus. That's only in theory, like about 30% of the time it breaks and you have to run a script command in the mission to make it work. So we had an annoying thing. So I wrote this function over here, it's part of the Xamfft, that guarantees that whoever is logged in as admin will always have Zeus. Even if you disconnect, rejoin, die, whatever, it'll always make sure you have Zeus. There's a special thing Xamfft does. The other special thing Xamfft does, you don't see over here, is, as I mentioned a few times already, a function that goes through all the objects in the mission and makes sure that they are editable by Zeus, like all the actual units and vehicles and crates and stuff. Okay, so that's that. So this is the base, and the best way to fix this one, let me see, probably just have to have it outside already. Park, there we go, next to that one. Okay, so this is the base. This is the base Xamfft, and the Xamfft gives you all the stuff for free, like respawning, like on the thing with your kits, all the slots and all that stuff. That basically that works out of the box, so you have everything. So we have a base, we have a blue force set up, and everything is ready. So before we go on to placing enemies, has anyone any questions? Anyone stuck or anything like that?
I'm good for now.
No, it seems great.
I'm with you.
Okay, cool.
Yep.
Yeah, so this is the base of Zamf. So there is one extra thing we might want to go about is about uploading missions and stuff like that, and the mission names and stuff, because we're actually going to rename the folder that the mission is in, but we'll do that later, since that let's just build a mission first. Okay, so what we want now is we want to have an enemy force, populate an enemy force. Now I'll probably leave it up to you guys. I can make it a very vanilla mission, like no lambs, no nothing. So you basically have to do like a trigger. I'll explain trigger boxes. Actually, we'll still have triggers even if we don't do it, but we'll have trigger boxes and more sophisticated use of waypoints and stuff like that. Or we could rely heavily on lambs. Or we can even rely on NR6, which is more like a higher level thing. So, well, technically we could use live, but live is not as good for these kind of missions. So what do you guys want to do, like vanilla, or do you want to do lambs?
I don't know any of those. I've played a little bit of vanilla, but...
You know what, I think maybe...
Lambs, at least.
I think I would recommend lambs. It's very easy to use, but I think what we'll do a bit of both. We'll do some basic vanilla movement. I'll show you how those look, and should be fairly simple.
Sorry, what is lambs? I guess it's not the thing I put on the braai. It's not the thing I put on the braai. What is lambs?
Well, lambs is it's two things. One, it's low level FSM, so that is low level logic for how a unit behaves when it gets shot at. So, like, if I were to shoot at a guy, how they would react, and very basic flankings, how they would enter buildings. So I'll explain lambs just now, in more detail. I'll just give an overview now. And the other thing lambs is a collection of scripts that they perform, like assaulting an objective or occupying buildings or this and that.
I see, that's important. Yeah.
So what I'll do first, I'll just do some basic vanilla interactivity. So what I'll do is I'll do a patrolling vehicle, and then I a patrolling vehicle, and then I will do a what should I do the patrolling vehicle? Yeah, I'll just do
it down the runway.
Yeah, up and down the runway. That'll
really next annoy, to the runway.
That'll really annoy ATC. I'll just have him kind of drive more or less around an area. It's fine. I'll have a drive around these towns. Okay, so let's do that. So generally you want to avoid convoys that can be very annoying and armor, even for experienced mission makers. So maybe like one vehicle is usually best. And dismounts complicates things, like enemies inside of it, but you know, I still use them. But I think let's go to let's decide what our faction is going to be. North Koreans, that's always fun.
Yes.
So let's do North Koreans, let's do a car, let's do a UAZ. Do not have any, they can't afford machine guns on the UAZs. They can afford a meta.
It's censored.
Into one cockpit in somewhere.
Yeah, let me see.
Yo, where's the Toyota?
Anyway, okay, let's do a Metis guy. So let's start over here. Let me do this. So waypoints, fairly simple. I think, wait, yeah, shift right click. Is it shift right click? Let me check. Yeah, so actually you need to, let me just explain one other thing with a unit. So inside a unit, there's the actual vehicle itself. So this is this vehicle, and then there is the drivers and the guys. So you have a vehicle object itself, it has its own, it can have its own init and everything. Then you have like one guy inside, you can drag him by default, he'll go into the driver position. So now you have a driver which has his own init inside of the vehicle, and then you have another guy that automatically goes into the gunner. And you can, if you look zoom down, it might get a bit confused. If you zoom in on the vehicle, if you click on it, yeah, if you hover over, you'll see them here and here next to it. You can just double click on get to a specific guy. Yeah, so that's each of them. And then you have this thing above. This represents the group. Now, you don't have to worry about this, actually, most of the time. We'll touch on one thing, probably. So this is a composition, which is basically represents a group, in a sense. This represents the group object. You don't really have to worry about it that much, but I'll just so you know what all this stuff is. Okay, so let's go to waypoints. So waypoint, I'm just going to do a starting waypoint. And
shift left click, right?
Yeah. Shift. I'm going to select the group and then shift right click. Right click.
Shift right.
Yeah. So first thing you probably want to do, you want to click inside. You go to waypoint state. This changes basically the behavior. So combat mode not important. Behavior, you want to start safe. So some minor differences between safe. Safe, obviously, they turn on the lights and they're not very aware. If you go to obstacles, like if you go to combat, they always turn off the lights, and then obviously super, like they move very cautiously. So if we were to take a vehicle and we were to, let's say, do this, let's say I want to have them go over here. I think,
but it follow the road though.
Yeah, so that depends on the mode. So let me actually do this. So let me do this guy. Let me do normal UAZ. And then let's do this over here as well. So hopefully I can show some differences. Actually, let me go further out just in case. So this one is for that one. So let me go here. So this one I'm going to make behavior is combat. And this behavior is safe. Okay. And when I spawn, I'm going to I move my spectator slots up there. So as soon as I spawn, I go right over there. No, but these civilian guys are going to be invisible and invulnerable. So you can actually place them anywhere on the map, and no enemies will react to them.
Yes, and then you can go into Zeus, and it's quite easy then.
Yeah, you can just Zeus and see exactly what everyone's doing, yeah.
Contact.
So this one on the right is combat mode, one on the left is safe mode. So in theory, this one, the dangerous one should go right off the ground, but this AI is kind of unpredictable. Okay, he's trying to overtake this guy. It's always fun watching the AI drive. You're going to see the disaster at this stage. Okay, so it looks like it's not behaving as I expected.
It's going to
It's behaving as always.
Okay, losing the race. It's not overtaking up. Does he have the power? Does he have the power? He doesn't have a meta, so he has less weight. You make.
What is on the animals?
He's tailgating. He pushed him off the road. Oh, he came back. Okay, so it looks like they didn't behave as expected. Actually, I'll tell you what I'll do. Let me use AI. So when you go in Zeus, you can actually experiment with things without having to do the whole Eden editor. So I'm gonna have these guys here. I'm gonna have these guys here. These guys are going to be safe. These guys are going to be in combat. So now, if I tell these guys to go here, and these guys to go here, you'll see these guys will automatically go into like a column, because so LAMS actually modifies formations if they're in safe mode to like a column. You see these guys are like doing bounding overwatch kind of.
Cool. And this is all vanilla.
Yeah. This might be tweaked by. This is 95% vanilla. This, for example, is not vanilla. Normally, the formation this formation over here is set by LAMS when they're safe. So LAMS, there's one feature of LAMS is dynamic formations that make sense for the situation. If they're safe, they're just walking around a column. Like, for example, if these guys are now aware, contact is probable, then they're going to switch into the formation I chose for them, which is line formation. At least in theory, they should start doing. Let me have this guy stop. You'll see that the guys, when they're aware, they'll actually move faster. Okay, there we go. Now they're in line formation. See, the guys in combat will actually move slower. And the fastest formation is usually a wear. See, you guys are like moving really cautiously, and these guys are just like advancing to contact. Like, and technically, that those people are doing advanced contact properly, but these guys are just chill. Okay, so let's go back to the editor. So let's just do the waypoints. So let me just start them off. Safe behavior, and then I'm just going to have him do a cycle. So here, cycle, let's then go here, and then go here. And then the last waypoint, here's where we talk about waypoint types. By default, when you place a waypoint, it's a move waypoint. So if you double click, you'll see the different type of waypoints over here. I recommend, I'm probably just going to tell you guys, the most useful thing for making missions is if you go to Google Arma BI Wiki, and I'm just going to go inside here. This wiki page is very useful. It's mostly for script commands, but we can do waypoints. Waypoints Eden editor. No, there we go. Script command. No, let's do waypoints. Let's just do Eden. There you go. Editor waypoints. There you go. Here, and this basically explains exactly how to place waypoints and like what to click. And you can, attaching waypoints to objects and stuff, waypoint completion. So I'm not going to go through all the stuff. I recommend you guys have a look at it. It also explains different types of. The different types of waypoints. This explains all the stuff in the Eden editor. And then the thing I actually wanted to get to was a waypoint. No, that's not it. So sometimes you get this is for scripting, so you can all that. Waypoints, I think. Yes. Okay, there you go. This shows you all the different types of waypoints. Like you have this, you have get in, get out, guard. Movement, hold, join, list, that, whatever. So the one we're going to use is actually cycle. It's right at the top. So this waypoint type will change a group's active waypoint to the nearest waypoint other than the group's previous waypoint. That's all we're going to need. Interesting. So yeah, it'll actually consider the way you place them as well as a waypoint. But anyway, the point is, with a cycle waypoint, you'll see the cycle actually points now to the start, it'll point to this one, whichever one's closer. So what it'll do, so let me just actually make it like this. What the cycle waypoints will do, it'll just have them basically restart the cycle again. So I'll show that, and then also show you one trick to make things go faster. So hold on.
So we'll be like a little patrol.
Yeah, this is basically an infinite patrol, yes.
Hey, I'm here, guys.
Hello. How's it?
Hey!
Okay, so one thing to make your this when you're in single player, you can actually on your keyboard row, you can press the plus key. You press plus and you'll see time x4. That means now this is the faster you can go. Everything will go faster. So this is a great we'll do it for testing things. So now we can test this guy.
Please.
And then he goes next one. Now whenever they reach a waypoint, they do stop for a second and. But normally, you'll see I didn't place a waypoint at every kind of junction because they follow the road. They try to follow the road normally. The exception would be combat, but as we did the test, the combat just turned to a Kyle Army race. They don't always follow them. And then when you get over here. Oh, one thing I want to show you. I'm going to set this guy to combat. So now he's going to be like, oh, super combat now. But as soon as he gets back to the first waypoint, if he's too fast for me. Okay, still combat. Okay, never mind. It's supposed to set back to not combat. But anyway, so I think we'll just forget about that for now. But yeah, basically you see the guy going around. So that's an infinite cycle. So the reason why I thought it would set back to combat is because there's a waypoint. When it reaches this waypoint, it sets behavior to safe. It was supposed to do that. As soon as it got here, it would set back to safe behavior, even if it was in combat. So in theory, that's what it's supposed to do.
Will the vehicles always choose a road to follow instead of going like a crow flies?
They, well, in theory, like I said, if it's combat, then they're supposed to go as as the crow flies, more or less.
I think it depends how the terrain is as well.
Yeah.
So the AI pathfinding is that if it's a wheeled vehicle, they will generally try to stick to the roads. But if it's a tracked vehicle like a tank or a BMP or anything of that nature and it's in combat mode, then its rule for using the road is not really relevant. It basically goes anywhere.
Yeah, so it actually is a wiki article that explains this. I read it like years ago, so I think that's correct. So let's do the same experiment again. I just want to try them with tracked vehicles.
Safe, yeah.
Ish. We have the whole ZAS mission makers next week.
I'll do the first one. Last 5 minutes.
Contact, car.
We can do five.
Okay. So you see, the guys are turning out. These are safe. Combat is still apparently. So that's one extra thing to note. Is the combat journey when they are. Let it go. What is this guy doing? Oops, is that going to be true?
You'll get that quite a lot, so.
Yeah, okay, so it looks like they're still not behaving as expected. Maybe because the terrain is like. Too much. But maybe if I do. Let me mess with them. How do I get you to go off road?
Maybe if there's actually an enemy.
Okay. Now he decides he wants to go off road.
This is running down trees, everything. And other guys are still patrolling like crazy. They're on the other side.
Now this guy, he should stick to the road then. Okay, there it goes. Now we're actually able to produce the expected behavior. This guy's going off road, this guy's sticking with the road. Okay, there we go. Okay, so I think we get the idea. I think this is one thing I'll mention now where it's useful to actually be able to put some copy paste some minor scripts. So sometimes these AI, if you leave him to drive around all day, he'll eventually hit a tree, and if it's a wheeled vehicle, he'll pop a tire, and then like people jump out and they'll go on foot, proceed on foot. So one way I made a little script, so I'll probably show you. If I go to Discord. So let me zoom this. Yes, I can zoom in Discord. Okay, it's the maximum zoom I can do Discord. So hopefully it's, so if I go to scripting snippets, where is scripting snippets? In Office. So I'll probably make this more public, scripting snippets. Let me actually change the permission. Let me see anyone in. Let me see, add HQ missions office. Let's do private, corporal, SG, whatever, everyone above. Okay, so let's just do that. So member, yeah, member. Okay, so you should be able to, I think, who can access this channel? Okay, I think it's simple enough. I'm not going to go into much detail. So if you go to pinned, you can actually see like all sorts of scripting snippets I put there. So like I put useful things inside here. So I'm going to go ahead and do MP safe, disable lambs, add ace for wounds, disable damage. There you go. Disable damage, damaging tires through crashing. So I just jump here and I just take this code, right click copy, go into armor and be in it for the vehicle. So make sure you select the UAZ. So it's a UAZ method. In it here, you just paste that. And now it'll never, when they crash, it'll never damage the vehicle from a crash. So that's just, I don't have to necessarily use this, but this is just to let you know a process, a common process, how you might just put little scripting snippets from resources like our own channel here.
Mm. That's very useful.
You know what Phoenix is saying with regards to putting any of these scripting snippets, there's one little piece of code that I use quite regularly. Is when we need to get to an HVT into a certain building, and instead of the AI reacting and running away, You can put in a code called this, which refers to the unit, and then you go force speed equals zero. So you're basically forcing the unit to have a speed of zero.
Yeah, so let me see. Okay, so I mean, I guess might as well just show things that you can do. So let's have two guys. So which one looks... there we go.
See, you can never go wrong with Nikos.
So you see, Nikos, he's brave. He's like, he's a Chad. And this other guy is, you know, he looks... He doesn't look so manly. So here we are. I'm going to play this character. And then, so in theory, this is what Bucky's going to be talking about. You'll see the difference here.
I'm going to stand in one spot and shit his pants.
Pretty much.
Hold fire!
Oh, you're going to run away? Wait, please. Okay, looks like he's killed. So, that is a big difference.
No, is that not NR6 civilians interacting?
I don't think... No, I don't have NR6 enabled. It's probably LAM's thing, maybe.
Yeah, because LAM civilians also would take cover first.
Yeah, anyway, so it's... Anyway, it's fine. So, what Bucky is saying that this AI couldn't move even if he wants to. Actually, I could have given them waypoints and told them to move. Actually, yeah, I could preview again and do that, but this guy won't move, and that guy will move.
Okay, but you at the full speed, you typed in 5 and not S. Speed. Oh, okay, don't worry.
I put 0.
No, you see. Oh, is that the capital S? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, yeah. It's like a common accepted where any sort of abbreviated action or instruction or anything, we just generally capitalize the letter so you can read it easier.
Now let's do a basic, a very basic trigger. So let's say you want a QRF force to attack when blue four enters the base. So let's do basic triggers. So we have a trigger here. We can go to the area widget and we can actually drag it top. I can just make it select the whole base. The base is kind of square. So let's go inside. We'll make it shape square like this, a rectangle, not square. And now it's you can in the map mode, it's probably more obvious. You can see here the thing. And you know, what allows me to drag again is the area widget on the top left. So I'll just select the whole base. There we go. So now,
what does that block do?
This is a trigger. So what this does is it detects events and then triggers, basically, as the name suggests. It detects events and then causes actions based on those events. So let's describe it now. So the first thing you want is trigger activation. So type, none is fine. Most of the time we do none. Activation, so this is what activates it. So what triggers this trigger? So we're gonna do blue four, there we go. So if blue four enters this trigger is activated. And then we can also set a condition over here, so we can say detected by op4. So normally, if just present, as soon as a blue 4 goes inside here, they're going to be triggered immediately. Even if no one saw him, which is kind of unfair. So if he wants to only trigger when the op4 sees them, then we do trigger detected by blue 4. By op4, sorry. Obviously, they see themselves the same as present the whole time. So I'll do two triggers actually, one with that behavior, one with the other. So on this side of the airport and that side of the airport. So this side is going to be present. There we go. And then the other one is repeatable. So will this trigger happen over and over again? If you have like one set of reinforcements and then they attack, there's no point having the trigger again because there's no more reinforcements. And then server only. This is more for scripting, you can ignore that, but for scripting it might be, if you maybe I have script commands over here, you only want them to execute on the server. So, yeah, and then the rest is conditions, so you can leave this. This is more, if you want more advanced conditions, like I might select a higher number of people to detect, and on activation is is like script commands executed when a script trigger activates, and on deactivation things when the trigger is no longer active. You don't have to worry about that. So the next thing is countdown. So maybe you want to, once a condition is, you have countdown and timeout. So countdown is once a condition is met, the trigger will activate after the period of time has elapsed. So let's do this present. Let's do this timeout. Yeah. So,
yeah. And so just, no, that is in seconds, guys.
Yeah, seconds. So let me do 5 seconds here. And then for this one, I'm going to do the detected by op 4 timeout 5. So countdown means that the trigger will go, once the conditions are met, the trigger will trigger no matter what after 5 seconds. Timeout means the trigger will trigger after 5 seconds only if the conditions that triggered it are still true. So for this one, on the right, is detected by op 4. So if op 4 has detected a blue 4 inside its trigger area for 5 seconds, then it will trigger. So I'm gonna, so that's what I'm going to do. So let me just, I'm going to do one small script thing just so we know it's working. So on activation, so this one's unfit trigger activated. Oh wait, this is actually the fair one. Unfair trigger activated before present, and then fair trigger activated. So it's going to hint a message in the top right saying which when it's activated, so you can actually see it. You obviously want to remove that for the mission, but it's good for debugging. Okay, so
but I guess you'll have to put a guy from the red team in there, otherwise yeah. You're not going to be seen.
Yeah, correct. So I'm just going to run it, and we'll just see. Obviously, in Zeus, you can place it. I'll place them down in Zeus just now.
So. Okay, cool.
Contact, car, contact, man.
Okay, so to the left of, yes, knowing where the triggers are is an annoying thing. To the left of this tower is that. So if we place down any sort of blue 4 guy inside here,
ready.
Then the top right, after 5 seconds, you should see him top right here. There you go. Unfair trigger activated. Okay, now, if we go over here, we place a soldier. This is 25 FIA. Yeah, it's fine.
Ready.
If you place a soldier over here, you'll see after 5 seconds, it takes a while for the thing to fade, but it should say fair trigger activated, which it won't. So let's, now, let me place down a enemy man. Say, crewman. And this guy has to see me for his trigger to activate. Let me just go inside his gun. So hopefully he won't. So you'll see in the top right, it's not going to activate. Now it should still not. Okay, okay, now it's still activated. Okay, trigger, fair trigger activated on the top right. So I don't know how fair. Oh, he's still technically alive. So that's. Yeah. So let me try. Okay, so it's activated. Okay. The trigger's
now.
Yeah. So you see the trigger activated only after he saw me. But I think what I'll do is I just want to show. In theory, it should work that if he's completely dead, not just unconscious, then it should not activate actually. So this is probably one thing I might want to write a script for, just to make stealth missions a bit easier if you want to be able to assassinate people. There you go. Iraqi police will kill this guy here. If I wound him, he knows about me, and now he's completely dead. Yes. Top right, it shouldn't pop up. Okay, see, it doesn't pop up on top right. So that actually then worked. Yeah, and if I do pop, let me just, yeah, if I do pop up a guy. He knows about me. And then it'll pop up still. Okay, so yeah, there we go. Okay, so we know it still works. Okay, so you can see the basics of triggers. So everyone, people comfortable with the basics of triggers?
Yep.
Just about the I guess there's much more triggers than just those five triggers there.
Well, those are the basic the basic types, but we can do a lot more than what I'm showing you now. So I'll show you something practical now.
Phoenix,
yeah?
How do you define that, or how do you change the area for the trigger?
Oh, so I go to area widgets, and then you'll see, look at the sides, and you'll see these black things that you can just drag on.
Okay, cool.
You can also edit in the
real world. I've always battled to get the right area of the direct dimensions. I've always just changed the stuff on the init or the properties. Cool.
Yeah. By the way, there's also a height to the trigger. So if I were to set this to 100, then you have a height box. So if you don't want like UAVs to trigger a trigger, they can do that as well.
Okay, cool.
Is that trigger triggering?
Right now, the only thing it does is it sends a hint message in the top right saying a fair trigger activated. But well, now we're going to do something useful with it now. So I'm just showing you like Okay, so let's have a trigger QRF force, which is a very common thing. So let's have, we said we wanted North Korea. So let's have infantry, rifle squad. So we'll just have like two rifle User squads and a weapon squad. So there we go. I can put them in, you can put User them into one group. From your channel. You can hold down hold down control and drag, and you can actually group people. You select the composition thing on the top, and then you hold down left control, you drag, and then you can group them all to one mega group. But did I have it right? There we go. Okay, now there it is. So but one thing, though, it's actually generally better to have fewer groups because in a group, the lead element, the AI in the front, will do most of the processing, like almost all the processing. So if you have many group, like many small groups, then you'll have many more men doing processing. If you have one big group, you have one guy doing the processing. So it's more efficient to have fewer bigger groups than to have many smaller groups.
And if he gets taken out, how will the rest respond? Does the three smaller groups still, or?
Oh, no, they're all the same group, it's just a new leader is appointed.
Yeah, so the leader currently that you see there basically gets the instruction what to do, and basically does like a mirror copy to all the other AI. So basically the other AI pretty much on its own is fighting like the leader itself. As soon as the leader gets killed in the event of a war, he obviously goes into an incapacitated state. Doesn't mean the leadership role has been passed on. Okay. So only when he actually dies does that little leader block. Phoenix, we can probably show it by just deleting the unit as they move in, Phoenix.
Yeah, but we'll probably see a bit later. But okay, so I put the composition we talked about earlier, and I'm just going to just have them hold here. So we're going to have we need a waypoint. For this group, we need a waypoint that they're going to hold, like basically wait at until they're called in. So I'm just going to make this move waypoint over here. Don't do hold because as we was hold. So this waypoint type will cause a group will move to and stay at this position indefinitely. So then it's more complicated to get them out of it. So hold is actually like a permanent stop, even if you have other waypoints. So let's just stick to move. And then we want to make it, these guys are safe. You have descriptions of what each of these things are actually. Careless is if you get annoyed with the AI. Safe, and then a formation, I'm gonna try and get at something appropriate to like staying like almost like a go firm thing, but not really, it's diamond formation. And we're just gonna leave them like this. Then you want, then what we're going to do is we're going to synchronize this waypoint to the trigger. So you can right click, and you can say connect and set waypoint activation. Then I go down to the waypoint and I just click it on the waypoint. There we go. Now it's synced. So what will let me give you another waypoint. And what we're going to do now is we are going to do a seek and destroy. So we're going to press another waypoint here. I'm going to change this type to seek and destroy. So what seek and destroy does, as soon as they get in the area, they'll have a search pattern, look for enemies. So it's a bit more aggressive. Rather than just move there, they'll look around a bit. And then we're going to make behavior aware, not combat necessarily, because it'll take them forever to get there, as I showed earlier. Let's do aware. Let's do like a line formation, more scary to the oncoming blue four forces. And yeah, that's it really. Okay, so what will happen is the AI will move to this move waypoint, and then they will stop. And then when the trigger is activated, then they will rush down to where we place this thing. Where we place this thing, past 10. Let's have a look at this.
So you first put in a trigger, and then at the waypoint, you can say connect to that trigger.
Yeah, or you can place down the trigger afterwards, and you go back to the waypoint and right click connect to.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like, yeah, it's just you when you click select, then you can you can have a line. It gives you a line, you just move to the trigger and you click. Okay, so these guys, they are, you can see the safe mode, so they're just walking around, all relaxed in the forest, not really sticking to the, maybe they're kind of sticking to the formation. They're kind of clumped up in very small groups, so maybe that kind of makes sense. LAMS actually has some nicer functionality regarding this, but we'll cover that later. Okay, now, so we'll stay in there. Let's have a let's have an op four force. So let's have a North Korean infantry. Let's have a small group. Why do they have to have giant sections? Okay, let's have a team over here. I'm gonna make it much smaller. So we have a small, like, five-man team over there, and then we're going to have blue contact, four. Soldier. Oh, what contact are you talking about? There's no blue four here, so it's fine. We're going to have NATO infantry rifle squad. So these guys should make mincemeat of these Koreans, because they're 2035, better body armor, better weapons. Roger. That's gonna move them over there. And now, you have to pay attention to the top right when they get into contact. These guys don't know about them yet, so the trigger's not being activated. There we go. Now they see them, now they're engaging. Fair trigger activated, there we go. And now these guys are like, oh shit, we need it. Now they change mode to aware, so now they're moving, like, weapons raised, like, aware. They also got to change formation eventually. When they slow down, when the leader slows down, others catch up, you'll see the formation take shape. Now, basically, they're now running towards the area. You can actually see, if you go to Zeus, you can actually see the waypoints that you place in the editor also show up over here. So you can debug. You can see these guys are moving down here. These guys are a bit in trouble. These guys are still fine. Yeah. Also, just to show what Bucky was talking about. So in Zeus, if you click on a guy and you press end, not delete, end will end his life. Kill him. There we go. Now he's dead. And you'll see the leader mantle pop after a few seconds. There we go. New leader is this guy over here. He's probably the squad leader from the other group we spawned. The order in which they succession of command is based on ranks. I'll probably show you rank briefly. There you go. They're kind of forming a line now. They're moving in. The guy, the leader, didn't know how to do formations correctly, so I had to kill him. So now the formations are better now.
Okay. Is Phoenix, a warning?
Phoenix, what button do you use to go into Zeus?
Oh, my one is Y.
Yeah.
My one's still Y, yeah. There we go.
Okay, so okay. The figure was when the red got attacked, only then the squad will move into the base and support.
Yes, because so I think we get the gist of what's happening. So let me go back. And because if you look at the trigger, this is detected by op 4 and only after 5 seconds timeout. This trigger's conditions must be satisfied for the specified duration for the trigger to be activated. That's 5 seconds. So once detected by op 4, it must they must be the blue 4. Here's the activation blue 4 detected by op 4 for 5 seconds continuously. That's basically what this means. Does that make sense?
So yeah.
And the timer values, basically you can randomize it with
yes.
That.
Yeah, so if I do 5, 7, or 20, it'll be any number between 5 and 20, but it'll lean towards 7. So if you want to randomize it.
Okay, huh?
Yeah, I'll also just show you a rank thing, like this guy, for example. If you go to ranks, it's not really important, so nothing you have to deal with, but where's his ranks? There we go, rank here. This guy's a sergeant, and then like another guy next to him is like a private. So usually the higher ranks guys takes over next. There's also supposed to be some logic. One area where it is useful is in convoys. They have multiple vehicles. Traditionally, the highest ranked the driver with the highest rank goes in front, but I don't know if that's still the case. That was the case in Operation Flashpoint many years ago.
Tell me, where do you set the difficulty of those troops?
Okay, so by default, the difficulty, it's probably modified by lambs or alive or something. If they're like insurgents, it'll be lower. If it's not, it'll be higher. There is some modifications on the skills, but you can just set the skill over here. So if you want, if you want, you can select all the guys, and then you could right click properties, and then you can go to click this button to, because they have different skill values. So everything was differences between the units is faded out. But if you actually want to modify it and override for all the units, you can do this. You can make them all like really high, really low. One advantage of going really low though is because they have to do less thinking. It actually has less load on the server. So if you have a bunch of civilians that don't need to do any thinking, it's good practice to actually minimize all the skills. Okay, so that's
just in terms of the repeatability. Do you use it often or not?
What the skill thing?
The trigger repeatability.
Kind of. So I can show you on my last mission why I used it, but there's probably too much stuff going on over this, might be confusing. Maybe I'll show you a small version where repeatability might actually make sense. There's a couple of use cases. The only one on top of my head as well, I'll probably show you now. So let me go to a desert. I'll use this tarmac over here. There we go. So let me have a civilian there. There we go. I need to have a car here. Let me do a trigger. Let me do default 100 meter radius. That's fine. Actually, even less. It's fine. Let me do activation blue 4. Actually, no, make it op 4 because I don't want to put a blue 4 there. And detected by civilians. Actually, not even detected by civilians, just present. Okay. Instantaneous. Let me just do this hint thing. You obviously, now that we know this thing actually works, by the way, I'm going to take out this hint over here because you want to make sure you remove debugging stuff afterwards. Okay. So, blue op 4 detected. So, what we're going to have is I'm going to have this guy, when I'm gonna have him wait. I'm gonna sync that to the waypoint. Then he's going to move up here when something is triggered. Then he's going to move back down here, and it's going to be a cycle. There we go. And in this, we can allow repeatable activation. So now. So this is actually kind of useful for if you want a QRF to investigate an area and then go back to a waiting position. So if you want the QRF to be reusable,
yeah.
This is quite useful.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
I actually use that in my last mission. But yeah, the cycle never actually happened, but it would have likely worked. Okay, so let's put down an enemy to trigger. Triggered. So now he's going to drive. Let me delete this guy. Okay, let me just speed it up. What are you? Why did you stop the and get out? Anyway, it's AI, so we don't worry about it. maybe
he's got any branch
on. Maybe it's because he saw the enemy. So he's like.
He's like a little. Well.
It's kind of strange. It's kind of strange because he saw the AI, so as soon as the vehicle stopped, he was like, oh shit, and then he jumped up because apparently he's scared of the op 4. And then he's still loyal though, so he still goes back to where we're supposed to be.
Phoenix.
Yeah.
It's the vehicle. It's a Golf.
Oh, okay. Oh, it broke down.
Yeah, it broke down.
Okay. Okay, and now if you place an AME again, you'll see triggered again, and it'll repeat
the same. Ah, there you go. Okay.
Oh, he's gonna have some burns. In a very sensitive place.
He's not gonna get back into the vehicle. He's just gonna keep on crawling.
wait. He's calmed down. Wait, go ahead.
Oh, no, you get
wait,
no,
you got out.
Because I still don't want to start.
So you can see he's supposed to go back here. Oh, all right. He won't go back because this guy's intimidating. Okay, maybe he'll listen now. But I don't know why he's afraid of the op 4 by default. Though. It's only supposed to be when it's threatened. I don't know where he's going. He's hiding. Okay.
Yeah, I know what it is. I kind of you understand.
See, you see, in the, this is the utmost importance wherein you want to capture an HVT that 4-speed, because you can imagine ZA going after a guy crawling in the bushes in the middle of nowhere.
Okay, now he's coming back now. Okay, there we go. Okay, but he's taking
it. He's bloody strategic if you ask me.
He's flanking.
This is combat mode. Literally, it's combat mode. That's what. Right. Okay, he's like making sure the area is clear. Okay. Now, wait. Will he take the vehicle? Oh, he didn't finish the vehicle.
Very good.
Or did he? Oh, no. Okay, now he's taking the vehicle. Okay, there we go. Okay, there we go. So you get the gist of it. Okay.
Oh. Phoenix.
Oh, by the way, the awesome. Speaking of HVTs, okay, so let's actually make it one of the mission objectives is actually to rescue someone. So let's go to civilians. Shannaros has some nice functionaries and suits, so that looks important. So we're going to have this guy inside this building over here. So, you can do a 4-speed 0, but if the guy's like a hostage or something, then you go to attributes and you can actually make him surrendered or handcuffed. So you can do one or the other. So I make him handcuffed, and then when you start the mission, it'll see his hands behind his back. He's just handcuffed by using ace, and he won't go anywhere. So that's actually like Bucky uses 4-speed 0, but what I always do if it's an HVT and I want him to stand where he is, I actually make him surrender. The reason for that is that he's technically sitting there surrendered the entire time, but so hold on, let me do. There we go. The guy looks unarmed. No, maybe not. Yeah, whatever. So if I go here and I do, making it surrendered. So. The reason why I prefer making units surrendered is, first of all, I think it looks a bit better, like you see the hands above his head. That's the reason why he's not running away or fighting back, because he's surrendered to you. And then if you do handcuff him and release him later, he might like unsurrender right away. So that's a more realistic concern. You can see this guy is surrendered, hands above his head, and he won't move no matter what. And then this civilian is handcuffed, so he also won't move no matter what. So if I go in as a blue 4 rifleman, when he spawned in Zeus, they go at the ground floor. So let me go over here.
Just one thing that Phoenix mentioned. When Phoenix placed the AI in the mission itself, he placed it as an op for the red guy.
Yeah, he's here.
Yeah. So what happens is the armor engine. If you are injured, you go from blue 4 to civilian. If you are handcuffed or surrendered, you go to civilian.
Yeah, it's a special thing called captive, captive state, which looks like civilian, and yeah. So if I toggle surrender now this guy is no longer. He's gonna pull out his gun. He's gonna. What? Yeah. Oh, this is exciting.
There we go. Target neutralized.
not a very
low budget movie.
Not the sharpest tool in the shed.
Question is, how do you do the surrendered and stuff again? I tried it with my own guy and I didn't know how to do that.
So in Eden Editor, Zeus.
Yeah.
Well, in Eden Editor, you right click, you go to attributes, and then you scroll down and you will see at the bottom Ace Options. You'll see handcuffed or surrender. You can take either one of those.
Okay, and in Zeus?
In Zeus, it's... okay, so I will... Do I have guys? Wait, do I have... Actually, I don't have patrol. Okay, so what I'll do is... I'll just show in Zeus. Okay, so you go to create in the top right, you go to modules, and then there's only one thing there, and then this is where most of the fancy stuff with Zeus is actually inside here. There's the lightning bolt, remote control, and then what thing we're looking for is Ace AI, I think. No, which one?
Utility.
But I have to explain it. I always forget which one it is. No, it's not used, though, too.
Okay. Oh, no worries.
Captive. It's captive.
Yeah.
Toggle captive, toggle surrender. There we go. So we can toggle captive here. But we still want him to surrender instead.
Oh, okay, cool. Brilliant.
Okay. Okay, so...
Are we going to do a year's worth of tutorial to understand all this stuff? How long did it take you, man, to really make your first mission work?
Well, technically, you have everything you need to know now. You can just have, like, place AI down, put them waypoints, QRF, place guys down, and that's basically it. I think the last thing we'll do is I'll just a brief introduction to LAMS, and we'll have a nice populated... We'll do some nice stuff with LAMS. They'll do some... make some things quick for us.
Just before you go, you said now someone needs to go and rescue him. How will you set up a guy then to, let's say, drive there, take that guy in his little suit, you know, to go and take him and rescue him?
Well, for AI, extraction. Instructions for an AI, that would be difficult. That's the reason why we leave it for a player controller.
So what I'm saying is that the person will rescue. That's what we're going to do at base as players. We're going to go and chop and go and rescue the guy. So we play. I'm just going to place down a marker here. I'm going to say objective is. Let me see. Let's make it green.
In other words, you can't say opt for to go into a town and capture someone and drive away with him.
Not without a bunch of scripting.
Okay.
Okay, so or someone writes a script for you, then it might be easier to use. Just one line in it and maybe it'll work. Like whenever I make scripts for people to use, I try and make them as easy as possible. Oftentimes it just involves like placing a thing in an init and then syncing stuff together and then you're done. Okay, so for marker, I just in the text is actually what you see. Variable name is for scripting, so text you want that. So that's then you see HVT building over here. There you go. So now let's do some LAM stuff. So LAMs, where is LAMs? So we have two.
Sorry, is that special stuff that you need to download to import, or is it already in our mod, Eden Editor?
In the mod.
If you're running with our mod line, you'll see it.
Okay, cool.
So I'm going to system modules and you go to LAMS. You'll see on the right, you'll see two different LAMSes. So what we'll do is I will do a garrison first. So this is a kind of a big one. I mean, I'm going to use it as a big one. It can be as big or small as you want. So I'm going to select the area that I want them to garrison. So just like the trigger, I'm going to use the area widget. I'm going to select the area I want the AI to occupy buildings with.
Sorry, what is garrison exactly?
Go inside the building and hold.
But basically, that if you're asking for the definition of the word, then yeah, it's
garrison. Yeah,
it's go inside and protect something, I guess.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so that's garrison. And then I'm going to, then what you do is you just take a bunch of enemies. I'm going to take, actually, I'm going to cheat. I'm going to copy paste those guys. There we go. That's all the enemies. Very large force garrisoning this very wide area. I'm going to then take one of them, usually the leader is good. Not the composition itself, because you can sync the composition, but you want to, normally in scripts, you synchronize the units, not the diamond on top of them that represents the group, but just any one of the units, normally this. And you say sync to, synchronize to. Grouping is if you want to have it to go to another group, and trigger owner is something more complicated with triggers, but we're just going to do sync to. Sync to the garrison module, and technically they'll garrison. I was going to tweak some of those things. Inside the garrison, you can say exit trigger. So as it says here, the condition for units to leave the garrison position, it's on a per unit person. So sometimes they might exit the garrison if they're fired, if they've shot, or if someone's shot near them, or if they've been hit or something. Also, I like keep it on random is fine because it makes it kind of unpredictable slightly. Sort positions by height means they will always take all the positions on top. So if we do this, they'll spawn on the roofs of every building and almost nowhere else until there's no more space left on the roofs. So that's a bit silly. So we'll undo that. Yeah, I do use it sometimes if I really want to have like a small group of men and I want them to be at the top of a building, so maybe use a building for Overwatch, and I do that. Teleport units. So this one is useful. You want to use this for the start of the mission. So they'll just teleport to the where they want to be initially, and that's it. If you somehow use a toss garrison in the middle of a mission, then you probably don't want to teleport because it might look weird if someone observes that. And dynamic patrol. So this will create a subgroup to patrol the area. So it'll just create a free patrol for you, just like that. And then that's it. So it'll work. Here's one thing though. This is where multiplayer stuff can get a bit complicated. So it'll work here in a single player, but it won't necessarily work on the server. And that's happened sometimes because what the server will do is it'll actually move these AI to a different headless client, like you probably saw them HCs, in order to offload from the server. And when it does that, it'll actually break the LAMP script. It won't know what they're doing. So what I often do is place a trigger. This is another use for triggers. And I just call this, so this is, hopefully won't be too complicated, but maybe I should put in the scripting snippets. But I just call this HC delay, although that's not important. And I say condition to true. So that means a condition will always be true no matter what. And I just set countdown now. It doesn't matter which one you use, to 60 seconds. I'll just do it 10 seconds for the purpose of this, but usually I make them 60 seconds, 1 minute. And then you sync this to this. So this is the only bit that you might have to worry about when you actually want to load it on the server. So again, it's just a trigger that I just set condition to true, which means it'll always be triggered no matter what the start, and I just set countdown to 10 seconds, or 60 seconds. When you actually, for testing, you can lower it for the server for 60 seconds. So what this will do is actually, I'll show you now.
Contact.
So what it'll do is you'll see these guys haven't done anything yet because it's going to wait 10 seconds before that works. So the point of this delay is that when the mission starts, it takes like a few minutes for the units to be moved to a different headless client. Not a few minutes, like 30 seconds. And then once it's moved, then it's safe to start the LAM script, and then it'll be fine. Okay, so there we go. We have the guys. They've automatically moved. One of them is this. This guy killed and was teleported into a wall, so he died. But everyone else is fine. And then we should have a patrol. There we go. And they have one dynamic patrol over here, just patrolling around automatically the whole area we've defined. Okay. So everyone comfortable with this use of LAM?
Yeah. Yep. Just go back to LAM's little menu.
Okay.
You've got all that stuff. No, where you inserted the LAM.
Oh, So I go to systems, and here on the right, you go to LAMS. Here, there's two LAMS ones. Garrison is over here under the danger waypoints.
Okay, so there's the patrol, the CQB, TOS camp.
CQB is for attacking, okay. So you can literally have them. You can literally have an AI try and do CQB, do building clearance, like they stack up in entry. It's kind of interesting to watch. Very nice attempt at actually the best I've ever seen AI trying to do CQB. It's actually quite interesting. Then there's TOS patrol. So I think we'll do a patrol. Let's have a wider patrol. So another one. Let's do this. So this is like a wide area patrol. So let's have like a wide area patrol. I'm gonna sync this to the HC delay here for safety. So you can use the same trigger for as many things as you want. So you don't have to make any triggers.
That trigger is just there just to make sure they definitely do that and it doesn't bug out somewhere.
It's there to give the server time to move the AI around before it starts the script, to avoid the script moving around to break the script. Okay, so let me place down a squad, but I want them to be more like a smaller patrol. And then I'm just going to sync this guy up to... here. And then this guy, I'm going to say dynamic waypoints. You can set number of waypoints. I'm going to make it... area's quite big, so I'll make it 8 waypoints. Dynamic patrol pattern. So every time they reach the end, they'll have new waypoints from scratch. I'll leave that off because it's probably nice to encourage humans to learn waypoint patterns to avoid them. Oh, it's endemic reinforcement. This unit will respond to known enemy positions that are identified by allies. So it's nice to have that on. So if there's a fight nearby, they'll stop the patrol and go assist. So yeah, we have that. We'll see how that looks.
Contact! Car! Contact! Rifleman!
Yeah, so we have to wait a few seconds. Okay, and then now these guys have been given waypoints. So you'll see the waypoints they've been given has been like... You can see the white ones. You can see like all over the place, kind of random in the area. And they automatically are given a safe stance and a column. So you'll see safe... Well, this is stacking column, but they're actually doing column. And this guy's trapped on the other side of the fence, so he has to go around. Oh, he's not that far. So there we go. For relatively easy, we got a patrol that's random. So every time you play it, it's different. So it's Mission Maker doesn't know where the patrol pattern is. Mission Maker doesn't know which buildings these guys are inside because it's all random. So there we go.
Oh, okay.
So that's how you randomize it, basically, so that the Mission Maker can also play and pick the surprise, basically.
If you still want to surprise, yeah. Like this guy, for example, we know exactly where he's patrolling and how he's doing it. These guys, we have no idea how they're patrolling. So this is the LAMS way, and then that's the manual way.
Is the life that you spoke about, is that also in that menu where you got the LAMS?
It is. We're not going to cover it. Actually, you know what? I'm going to very briefly do one useful thing that'll be useful for us. I'm going to show you, it's okay if you don't have to remember this exactly, but this is probably something that I should do most missions, actually. So I'm going to select a trigger, it's not a trigger, I'm going to place a marker. So you go to markers, and you place, you select, instead of point markers, which does stuff like this, you go to areas, and do a rectangle. A rectangle is saying that it used to be only work with rectangles, maybe it works with ellipse now. I'm going to select all the areas that I want civilians to spawn at. They should ignore the military base. No, actually, I'll just do this. I'll call this Civ 1, just in case there's more. I'm going to now go to systems. I'm going to go to alive, and I'm going to place two modules, civilian placement and civilian population. So civilian placement is this TAOR marker. TAOR stands for Tactical Area Responsibility.
Okay.
That's the one marker. That's okay. So now it knows where it wants to place them. And then technically the rest is done. You don't have to do anything. But let me just check. Civilian population, you can say like crowd sizes, like lots of advanced functionality won't go over here. Apparently ASEX has humanitarian supplies. Like, you know those MREs and stuff? So where you can use them, you can actually give them to civilians and it'll become less hostile to you. That's actually what the system is used at. Even if you actually used it before, but that's what actually built in functionality. The whole thing where you can shoot civilians that get more angry at you, they could potentially like go get IEDs and this and that, and you can give them MREs and they're happier with you then. So the whole system is actually built into
hearts and minds.
Yeah. So the civilian population is just a general system for managing the system, like the AI system in general. A placement is for specific areas. You can add multiple markers if you want. What I'm going to do, I'm going to change the force faction. I'm going to use Chernarus. So this is now slightly more complicated. In order to say what faction you want, I go to config viewer. I go to, you'll see this whole list. I go to CFG faction classes and I look for civilians. So I know it might be a bit complicated, but I'm just going to, just so you see what the end result looks like. Let's do Chernarus. Middle Eastern, no. Okay, apparently the CFP has a Melden faction. Okay, so I'll just take this class and then I'll place it inside here for the vehicles and for the players. You'll get the faction. So faction, what factions are is these things you see on the left. It's Al-Shabaab, Al-Qaeda, and they're all on the same side, but they're all different factions. Islamic State, this and that. These civilian factions. Oh yeah, I don't have groups of civilians. So go here's the, we'll be using this set, this Melden here, these civilians. So it'll be just some men and some cars, nothing special. And so that's what this tools config viewer, that's what this is, CFG factions, basically everything you see on the right menu, like the groups up there. Anyway, so that's how I tell it what kind of civilians spawn, and that's it. So now if we load this in.
Sorry, just a quick one. You only, that little area, the square area that you've put in there, you've only attached it to one of those.
Not even attached. So I just place this area, and then inside the placement, which is TAOR marker, I just put its name there. That's it.
Yes, but in the other one, you didn't put anything in the other.
Well, because there's nothing to. This is a different kind of module. So this same population, this you can think of this as settings for many of these. You can have many of these. This affects the settings of all of them.
Okay.
So let's have a look at how civilians work. So this is. I'm just showing you pretty much the alive stuff we use 90% of the time, and we don't most of the time we don't use anything else from alive.
Just for reference, in the 5 years that I've been doing mission making, I've probably used the live 10 times. It is very powerful, but I tend to just accept that working with LAMs and NR6 now, you know, you can do some really good shit.
Yeah.
I think
what
the live
NR6.
Yeah, so I'll explain just now the history of it because I was there before Alive or NX6 existed in the base system. But let me just first show you quickly. Here's civilians spawning dynamically. So if I were to then move my camera over here, these will despawn, gone, and now these guys will spawn. So it helps with server load. And these are remembered. So if this guy dies, let me kill this guy. So this guy, remember, he's dead. I move the camera somewhere else. They despawn. And then I come back, you'll see that they'll spawn back in the same places, except this guy's still dead. So remember stuff like that. Same thing with vehicles.
That's
that.
Cool. Yeah. It saves a lot of power on your server.
Yeah. These guys will also go about the daily schedule. So during the day, they'll walk about and do stuff. If there's some blue four around, they'll probably be like...
Standing by.
Like, maybe they might... form a crowd around them or whatever. If it's nighttime, they'll stay inside the buildings and they'll lie down and like kind of sleep, sort of, with their eyes open, very creepily. Okay, so to tell you basics of where this comes from, the Alive comes from, what's the system for Arma 2 called? It was a system for Arma 2, a different name, but similar thing. The point of it was persistent campaigns. So you have like a server, like a database somewhere, and you can exit the mission, but all the locations of everyone will be saved. And then you load the mission again, you resume from where you left off. And then there's a bunch of tools around that. So the point was to have dynamic campaigns. And Alive's basically Arma 3 version of that. The there is a strategic command system for Alive, which I'm not going to go over now. I'll just show you the modules. So you get objectives with Alive modules. Yeah, you get military custom military objectives, like have an area, and I think it'll tail marker, and it'll load those as objectives. Then you have, come on, I haven't used it in a while, but you'd have a commander, military AI commander, and all that stuff, and you can give them some settings and whatnot, and then you can synchronize, you can sync units to the system, to the Alive system, one of our markers actually. So this Alive virtual AI system, you can actually synchronize any AI to it. And they will actually become part of the Alive system. It will despawn and respawn, but it'll break other things like lambs and whatnot. So you actually don't really want to use that for, unless you're sticking with Alive. And what will happen, so all units that are syncs, that have virtual things as part of Alive system, and all the commanders that are on their side, so like this guy is a faction, you can make like whatever, will be a custom faction class here over here, but let's say CSAT, whatever. They'll actually go and like look at objectives. They'll send a scout team first, check if there's any enemies, and they'll send a main force. They'll hold it. They'll move on to the next one. This and that. And that system, that logic, was inherited from a script called Hetman. Hetman we actually used for a short time as a script by itself in like 2013, before Live even existed. And Hetman basically does that. You give a certain objectives and a commander, you synchronize them together, and then they know to attack those objectives, like to do scouting, send forces, this and that, like a high command kind of thing. And Alive uses a heavily modified version of that. What NR6 is, NR6 basically takes that Hetman and just, because Hetman hasn't been maintained for like 6 years. So NR6 basically continues with that. It takes Hetman and basically does some tweaks and stuff and has some tools around it, extra tools to give you for mission making. So NR6 is originally started as, I think, as just as a system around Hetman to give you high command commanders, but they've added a lot of extra tools now. Including their own civilian system, this Alice, which is also a civilian system, but it doesn't work with headless clients right now. So that's a bit annoying. It's quite different from the Alive one. The Alive one is much more sophisticated. This Hetman one is called Alice 2 because it's a script from Operation Flashpoint made by Bohemia Interactive, which is quite good. And then for some reason they didn't bring into Arma 3. I have no idea why. It's simpler. It is simpler, basically. I do want to use it, but I'm in the Discord. I'm just wondering when I'll ask them if they'll fix it. So I offer some suggestion on how they can fix it. We'll see if they do. So I won't touch NR6 right now. There's YouTube videos we could recommend afterwards. Bucky's can probably recommend some, because it's better suited that you just watch a YouTube video on how it works and then you're sorted. It takes 15 minutes to watch a YouTube video, and then you know the whole gist of the whole system. Mm-hmm. There's still lots of stuff in the system, but the core of it is easy to grasp.
What did you use to put intel into buildings? If we in missions we need to go and collect intel, what did you use to put the intel?
Cool. So you go to objects, props on the top on the right, and then I just do a search for intel. It'll either give me a 9900K or these things over here. There we go. So, okay, bad joke. Well, Bucky's here, it's fine. So we have ASX Intel items. So you want to use ASX. There's lots of Intel items, but ASX is the ones that we use. So let's say a document you put over here. Actually, Notepad, I'll show you first. Notepad here, you just double click, and then inside, if I remember, there we go. This text over here. This is this Intel text you see. And that's it.
Okay.
And then a photo, what you have to do is you have to copy paste a photo into your mission directory, and you put the file name here.
Okay.
Yeah, and it'll show it up. So maybe I'll actually I don't want to
user disconnected from your channel.
My file browsing, maybe nah. I don't know if I want to actually do file browsing. So right now I don't know what files will show up. Anyway, so and these
yeah, but items, I get the idea.
Yeah. And these Intel items will be here. So yeah. Okay, so that's yes, now we have Intel with your HVT that you can capture some extra Intel for bonus points. We can We can put it on a table, maybe. Where's the office table? Office table. There we go. New one. Here. Yeah. Is the thing snapping? Wait. Now snapping. Yeah. So there we go. You'll see in the blue thing. You'll see a horizontal line appear when it snapped.
Yeah.
Yep. There we have that. And the table. Remember, I'm going to just in case go back and simple objects. And even this for extra bonus points, but I think simple object is enough. So it's very, doesn't add any extra load. But this one, you don't want to make disable simulation or simple object, otherwise you'll break it. The things you want to interact with, you don't do any simple object or disable simulation. Stuff you don't interact with, you can disable simulation for load. I mean, if you have like a handful of objects, it doesn't matter. But if you have like a base with like 100 Hesker barriers, then you want to do it differently. Okay, so why is this thing still popped up? Okay, now it's gone. Okay, so we have that. We have the basic lambs, and then I don't know if I want to show the more advanced things with lambs. I think I'll just leave it over there because there's other things you can do. Let me just see if there's anything fancy. Oh, yes, I can show. Okay, so what I think I can do is. Yes, okay. So I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you an alternative way of doing this. This reinforcement thing, so using the lambs way. So I'm going to delete all his waypoints. I'm going to place down two lambs modules. The first one's going to be a camp. What's it called? This one I don't expect you guys to actually use per se, but this is kind of just gives you an idea. But you get the same you get the same results with your vanilla waypoints like I showed you, so don't have to do any of this. So this is the one that you use at spawn, so we've got teleport units. I want camp. So what's going to happen with camp is they're going to gather around the fireplace and make it look like a camp and have a mini patrol. There we go. Waypoint the group adopts after leaving the camp site. I'm not entirely familiar with this. I think we'll do seek and destroy just in case. Here, we sync to the lead. We sync to the HC delay just to be safe. Then we do task reset. So what task reset does in lambs is it deletes all the logic, all the anything they're currently doing. It'll make them forget about it in terms of lambs. So if you had them garrison, if you apply this to anything that's currently garrisoned, they'll stop garrisoning. They'll just say, hey, what I was doing over here? I'll start walking around trying to rejoin each other. So I'll sync this to this guy. But task reset will be synced to the QRF trigger, which is this trigger for blue 4. Is this? Yeah, it is. So after it gets triggered, they'll no longer be garrisoned. Then I will have to do another trigger, which is a rush. So rush, I'm going to have them rush here. Let's check.
Sounds like our training. That's what yes. You used to say, training.
Go group only targets players. Okay, whatever, it's fine. Sync, and I gotta sync to. I gotta hold down control so I can do both. I gotta sync to this guy. Okay, that doesn't work. I have to sync separately. Sync, right click, sync to. I'm going to make another. This is where it gets a very minor complication because we can't. I don't know which one's gonna happen first. Are they going to rush? Or are they going to reset the task first? So they might like get to rush first and then reset and it'll just sit there, won't do anything. So I'm just going to add another little trigger delay. This is why I don't recommend you do this like off the bat, but because then you have to worry about logic like this. So I'm just going to set this to
10 seconds.
Yeah.
Previous one was 5. So.
And I'll just think quickly the. Best way to do that. You can copy paste this trigger and have the same thing, but programmatically. Actually, wondering if this actually works. No, it doesn't work. Okay, so on activation, I'll just do this.
Sorry, Phoenix.
Go ahead.
Do you need me to hang around, or are you okay?
I'm fine.
Yeah. Sorry, guys. I just want to go help a little bit. I'll be back a little bit later.
Cool.
No problem.
Well, for Phoenix, how long are you guys going to be still? Hello.
Sorry, I was muted there. I'm just gonna just this is the, like the last thing, and then I'm going to show basic naming convention and uploading, just how we actually get the mission on the server.
Oh, okay.
So if you guys create any mission, we can put them on the server now if you want. Okay, so this is a trigger. This condition is not defined yet, so this is another minor complication thing. I'm going to go into pre-init.
User disconnected from your channel
equals false. So we have an so this is a scripting thing. Pre-init means that it just executes really early. So it says QRF is false. And then this thing, so that's when it evaluates, it doesn't know what the fuck is QRF, I don't know what that is. So we actually define it before the mission starts here. It's false, this thing will set it to true, oops. And then this thing will say, this thing's condition because it's QRF, okay, now it's true, now I'm going to execute. So I know this is all complicated, but then it should work. Okay, so let's have a look. Oh, let me just see if there's one thing I can.
Contact man.
Let me see if there's. Oh, one thing I recommend you guys do for parameters is when you start the game, I recommend you guys have. What is it? Yeah, there we go. So under in parameters, under author, you can go to show script errors. So if there are script errors, then you'll see the error. So at least you know that the problem is happening. So this is, I think, kind of important. So you know the script error. So probably hard to see, but in the Armor 3 launch under parameters, you go to author section at the bottom, show script error.
Test over. One click.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so now you see these guys are in a very messy big camp, kind of. What are they? Yeah, it is a camp because you have dynamic patrol over here. Like, why is this guy patrolling off center? Wait, where are all these other? Oh shit! Hold on, I accidentally left the alive system in, so there was like spawning and shit. Oopsie daisy. So the AI was literally spawning in forces at objectives. So, oh shit! No, that was the wrong one. Actually. We get the civilians. Actually, let me put the civilians back in quickly. Alive, civilian placement. And then we do Civ 1. I don't care about the faction, it's fine. Okay, let's go back. Okay. And then soon you'll see these guys teleport to position. Okay, there we go. So they're all bunched up in the same area and they're kind of specific. I think the size of the group is a bit too big for it to make sense, but we have a dynamic patrol patrolling around, sort of. I don't know why it's off center, kind of. Or kind of going through it. And then we have a bunch of guys just standing around the campfire. So it's a bit more dynamic. They'll probably spread out a bit more. Okay, so then let's say we have blue 4 attack, rifle squad.
Standing by.
Yeah.
Standing by.
These guys, got a task reset will be triggered. Oh, I think I forgot to add a delay to the trigger, so I don't know if it'll still work yet. Yeah, okay, it works. Okay, I was supposed to put a trigger, a delay on the other trigger, but it does work. So now you see the rushing. Now these guys are much quicker than they would normally be, actually. So rush is like a very example thing, like you experienced in training. With these guys, like they're not caring about, they don't give any shit. They're just going like, it's supposed to go a bit more straighter, but they're just going to go straight there as quickly as possible. So this one thing is really nice about lambs is if you want them to rush towards something, then with a lambs rush, it works like more 90% of the time at least. always tempted to just go and see how the scenarios play out. It's always a bit interesting. Let me show you the CTB quickly. So you can actually access LAMs inside you can use it. So you have LAMs modules over here. Most of the LAMs modules are actually over here. So what I'll do is I will place this quad here. I'm just worried about. Okay. Then I'm going to do LAM CQB on this building. And I'm going to select this group of sitting like this way, that's the one. And I'm going to just hit it. So now LAM is going to take over and say, okay, you need to assault this building. So I just want to see for myself what they do. See, so
but you didn't really assign it with that rifle squad, automatically decided.
It's a list. It's a list. So when you place it down, CQB, you have to select it from the list over here. So this one's the closest one, so I needed that one.
Okay.
See, they move towards the building in a like group together. This guy, he exited his CQB. Okay, now they're going to begin planning entry. They're going to stack up, and then they pull front rush inside. Please take a funnel, so you don't do that. Okay, there you go.
And that guy just doesn't die.
Now they're busy doing it. Okay, he's killing a dead guy. This is Fatal Funnel. This is why it's called Fatal Funnel. Inside with... How's this guy... Oh, he's got some... I'm just curious what's going on. This guy's... Oh, he's going through... He doesn't need doors. See, they're clearing all the rooms inside. So... Okay, he's double tapping. And another friendly in the back, maybe? Okay, so... Yeah.
Dragon 5.
Yeah, so one useful thing, let me just show you. So sometimes the word LAMS is really useful, because the HT thing I told you were sometimes the HT, the headless client, moving around the guys might break the script for LAMS. So if, for example, we have a... Sometimes when you load the mission up, you'll just see a rifle squad like sitting like this. LAMS didn't move him in or something like that, because it maybe took too long before the script... maybe they moved to another server after the script was triggered or whatever. But you can always fix it yourself. You can just go here, let's toss a garrison. You see the radius, so what radius the buildings will do. Let's teleport units. Normally in-game you don't want to teleport them, but no one's here, so it's fine. Dynamic patrol, so we'll make it like the other one. Okay, and there we go. Now we have the same thing as we had everywhere else. So these are useful tools. If something breaks in the mission, you can like do that. Okay, so that's pretty much. Also, task reset. So I'll show you how task reset works. So I go over here, and then if you do task reset, they're no longer garrisoning. They're all just moving back to where the leader is. Exiting a building and going back to the leader. So they're no longer garrisoning. Okay, so I think that's pretty much everything, also the tools we can use. Now, we basically have a functional mission where we have to go inside, sneak into the building, take them out before we get rushed by these guys over here and all that stuff. And we have wide patrols and this and that, we have civilians. So we pretty much have everything we need for a basic mission. Okay, so any questions, guys?
I think you covered pretty much everything.
All too new now, you just have to go and sit down and play.
Okay, yeah?
No, just to set up the map and so on that we...
Yeah, so the first part was most useful to get to get this guy's here, so set up and all that stuff ready.
Yeah, that was the most useful. And
yeah.
In terms of rounding off, for the map to basically show where's the enemy territory and things like that.
Oh, well, that's up to you. So here I will do it. So you go to the marker section, do an area marker. I'm going to put a rectangle. By the way, this marker that we placed over here for the sieve marker, when you give a marker to LAMS, where's the center of the marker? This is one annoying thing with markers. It can be hard to find the center. Wait, is that here? There we go. Sorry, there we go. So that's when you give a marker to LAMS, LAMS will then make it 100% transparent, so it's invisible. So in case you're wondering, if it's not part of LAMS, then what you see is what you get in the game. You'll see this gray box over here. So what I'll do is I will go here. I will select, let's say, diagonal grids are the nicest because they are the least distracting. Actually, the least distracting is, let's do a cross. There we go, cross. Cross looks least distracting. I'm going to make it this. I'm going to make it red. I'm going to alpha. I'm gonna make it slightly transparent. So 60% alpha, because it's kind of a large area. We want to do our own planning inside of it. And now I'm just going to drag it here. So we have enemy territory over here. There we go. So if we want to see what the mission actually looks like. Look inside here, we now have this. We just hide this texture. Hide this. There you go. So we basically have this here, and we have an HVT building. We just have to, we should actually mark where we start, so let me just do that. I'm not going to give it a name or anything like that, I'm just going to call it. And it's going to put down the NATO symbol for installation. So let's go to here, let's go to NATO blue for installation, and that's it. I'm not going to give it a color because the default color is blue for, which is perfect for us. There we go. So now we marked everything. We have a mission. Okay, so what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to show you just some basic convention, naming conventions and stuff. So, if you go to XAMPP's, the GitHub page for the XAMPP, if you actually scroll down, you actually see some basic usages. This explains pretty much all the stuff I showed you earlier about copying stuff over and some basic tips and stuff, deploying and whatnot, customize. Like the crates gear, so this is kind of handy. So you can have a look at the README if you want to explain the stuff we did in the beginning. So here the naming convention, we like to use this, though it seems to, actually I'll leave it. So what we'll do is I'll just change the mission to suit what I wanted to do. And I'll also show you why we do versioning as well. So let's do this. So number of players, mission file name, yeah, so the capital V, there we go. I forgot if it was capital V or small v. So what we do is let's save as, to make it change the name, for example. This file name is actually the name of the entire directory, the mission directory. This feels like it's for 12 people minimum, so I'll design it for 12 people, the target amount, 12 people. Operation test. Actually, we'll do op test because what you type over here is supposed to be what you see as a file name. No people in the mission selection screen, you shouldn't actually see this if you have it defined other place. I'll show you just now. So we have op test. V and then the hashtag. So just the versioning. Actually, it's V like that. Capital V, apparently. So I'm just going to name it. So if you rename a mission, then I'll show you what happens. Inside the mission folder, here's my old mission over here, but then the new one, co at 12 op test, you'll see it's blank. Then none of the XAMPP stuff inside here. So that's the annoying thing. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to copy everything just like we did earlier with the XAMPP. I'm just going to select everything.
I should then copy the mission stuff.
Yeah, hold on. One sec. Okay, yeah, that's fine. I want to move it because I want to delete this one because I don't need this mission anymore. It's deleted. There we go, deleted. So now this is what this looks like. Okay, so we have the mission, and then. We also want to put inside here. So this is what the person's going to see. So you can see here, I'm going to make it more human readable. One thing I want to show you is the reason why we put underscores and we use whole words is if you look over here, you see this %20 sign?
Spaces.
That's spaces. This is escaped space character. So when we export the file name will have these ugly things inside them. So if we use camel case, the words together, and we underscore the sections, then it looks much more readable like this. So I'm going to, so over here, however, we can do spaces if you want. I'm gonna do underscore just so that we know the section we're in, I think. And then here, I'm just going to do so I put 0.0, this is version 1. And I put dots over here, not in the other one, because you don't want dots in your file names. Too many dots might confuse some systems. It's generally dangerous. Okay, so we have the file. We have the mission file here, operation test. So this is the mission file name. The actual file name basically is going to be, and then this is the one that shows up in mission selection screen, at least in theory. Okay, so then what you do is what we're going to do is we're going to save, export to multiplayer. Then the way you find it. So this is going to be a little tricky. Not tricky, but. We have to do, let me just copy the URL path here and put it somewhere you can read it. When you export, missions show up over here. So it's program files, Steam apps, common, Armor 3, MP missions. So basically it's the Armor 3 missions directory in your Steam folder. And you go to MP missions, and that's where it's exported to. So on my side, I have a lot of junk over here. So after I export it, this is what the file name looks like. You see it matches the folder name of the thing. And what I do is I rename the file name, so it's 1.0.0. So the reason why I rename it after we export is because, remember, if we go inside the mission editor and we do save as to change it, then we lose all the files.
Yeah, first,
so it's actually much easier to just rename the exported mission over here. So there we go. So that's now the mission name. I'm just gonna. Hard for you to read, so I'm just this over here because it's small, so I'm just going to paste override. Okay, there we go. And that's the mission exported, and I'm going to upload it. So uploading, it's just in the Azure file storage. In the mission office, there's ways of explaining how to use it. It's actually broken for me, the normal way of using it, so I actually use a fancier file storage. But you can give me missions I can upload for you. So I'm just going to upload it. Wow, that sounded bad.
You're right.
I wonder if it's because he fell asleep on the chair and he fell over.
You might have died, boss.
Okay, so... yeah, so don't worry about this. ZA missions... Yeah, the reason why I'm doing this rather than FTP was because I used to kind of have a distributed system where, like, for the recce missions, I was supposed to spin up a server anywhere in the world, any moment, and they all had to have access to the same missions. So that's why I have a system like this. Okay. So I'm just going to drag, upload. And then it's uploaded. There we go. Now I will go back and I'm going to exit, and I'm just going to go to the thing. Server browser, direct, blah, blah, blah. Now, it might not show up because, like, it takes a minute it takes up to a minute. It's every minute it checks for new missions, basically. So if you happen to be lucky enough to go to the screen at the end of the minute, then it'll pop up right away. Where is it? It's Melden. No, I don't have op test. So first of all, I'm gonna log in. So I only have to type login because I have a special thing over there. But in our missions making channel, there's actually a special password listed over there. But I'll vote myself admin, so it should be the same, I think. If this vote on bottom right turns to continue, then you know you logged in. Yeah, it's probably better just to use a password. She's going to be changing the password soon anyway. But I don't have to show it on the camera right now anyway. Okay, log in. Yeah, there we go. Now I'm logged in. I know. Okay, so let me just if you need to reload this thing to show your mission, I'm just going to load up any random mission. Type in hashtag missions to go back to the mission selection screen. It's also how I end missions, by the way. Malden. And now we see it. There we go. Optest. So it has. Okay, this. It actually is showing our file name. So I have to figure out why it's doing that. I think it's some character inside here that it doesn't like. Okay, and then we have our slots. We didn't delete any slots, so we have all our slots. So I'm just going to here. We have our two headless clients have taken the two HT slots. If you remember from earlier, the thing we left there. I'm just going to go in as CO. Okay. I have the mission already because it's my MP missions folder, so I don't have to download it. But anyone else who joins will have to download it. Oh, you see, Operation Test shows up over here on the splash screen thing, so you can actually see the full thing I typed out over there.
Yeah.
And the description, some test stuff underneath there. But that title is supposed to show up on the mission selection screen as well. So, I don't know why it doesn't show up sometimes. You can actually see it up here. It shows up now, the proper thing. Sometimes a wait for host might delay a little bit, like alive. In this part of the loading, alive actually runs and indexes everything that you wanted to work on. So sometimes if it goes a really long time and you have lots of live stuff, then that's why. There we go. And we have our map, we have our markers, and all that stuff. So I'm going to continue.
Size and spawning.
You see, I was moved out of the channel. So that's one thing you have to remember when you preview a mission. Sometimes in a sort of multiplayer mode or dedicated server, an echo will kick in. Sorry, what were you saying?
Okay, yeah, of course. No, just in terms of optimization in terms of the enemy size and spawn in of enemy.
Okay.
Units.
Okay, so first of all, let me just check that everything is working first, and we'll go some optimization tips. So here we have the AI. Let me just check if the LAMs actually work. So one thing I always do is check the LAMs loaded in. Oh, I see. So LAMs actually. Oh shit! Because I made the thing not work with. Okay, these guys are still working. Okay, so because I left the HD delay at 10 seconds only, so that means these guys are now walking around because they don't know what's going on. So let me go and quickly fix this with the LAMs. LAMs, garrison here. Let's make it a big area. Teleport, dynamic patrol. Yeah, it looks good. Okay, so that's fixed. Well, that building has a big concentration. Oh, they're really, really biased. Okay. So everything else is working. This is working and this is working, so nothing else is broken. Good. Okay. So, first useful tool is go to any chat channel you have access to, monitor hashtag monitor one. It could be 1, 5, 6, whatever, but the number equals number of how many every second it shows you the server stats. So here we are, FPS 50. So if, for example, I were to like really load the server, just have a look on the bottom left what happens. Let me just spawn some guys.
Awaiting orders. Ready.
So it drops down a bit. It's not too bad yet because it's smart enough. So what will actually happen, when you first spawn guys live, they spawn on your own computer. And then AceX, which is what I was hinting at earlier, will move them to the headless clients after a few seconds. Okay, so then we have that. Now, if we spawn in some enemies, this is where this performance will drop a bit. So 72, hold it steady enough. Fire. So see, so 18 sometimes it dips, goes up. So server FPS, you want to keep that at around 50. Actually, you know, 50 is impossible. Not on the Talibot, it was 50 just now, as you saw. But 50 is a maximum. I would say you don't want it to dip below 20. 25, I would say, is like a minimum. When players join, the server FPS drops even more per player. So if you add 20 players or 15 players or whatever, you gotta lose it at 10 FPS from that, probably. So okay. Yeah, so this is the first way to monitor, to check how the mission's going. And then the other way of doing is counting AI. So this is more of a general rule of thumb. So here I have called count all units. So if you press escape, you have this debug console here. You don't have to worry about what all this is, but there's watch fields. You can use any of these watch fields. And what this is it just runs a script command every fraction of a second. So this one, count all units. So just one count and all units, one word. It basically counts all the units on the map, including blue 4, up 4, everyone. You can see the number is actually dropping because people are dying. So 170, it's not too bad. So you want to keep the total units below 200 as a general rule of thumb.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Now, there are tips to optimize. Okay, so we have... Okay, so I think we basically have our mission sorted. We have our base, all that stuff. That's basically the complete mission. I was going to show you some tips that you can use for optimization, actually. So go back to the mission make. Actually, I'll need to go soon, but I'll show you this stuff. Let's load the mission. So if we go to I forgot what the mission is. Test. Okay, there is one tool from NR6 that we can use. If we go to NR6 tools, and we, is it tools? I'm trying to remember which one it is now. ZBE caching, so caching system. So there's actually a couple of caching systems. Alive, actually, you saw one of them already. You know when the civilians despawned and respawned?
Yes.
Yeah. That's a caching, that's Alive's caching system. It's called profiling. So that's their system. It actually deletes stuff, has a version of them in memory. So it can actually move around units in memory virtually, have them even fight each other. And then when you're nearby, it respawns them. But the virtual states were like moving around and fighting in memory. That's not perfect. It doesn't simulate things realistically. It's just like a approximation. Then you have ZBE caching. This is a nice system. I just put it inside there and that's it. And I'll show you what it'll do. Oh shit, I might not actually work. I might be too close. My player character.
Contact! Car! Contact! Soldier!
Okay, maybe it might work. Yeah, let me teleport myself far away. Okay, hopefully it'll work. Ah, there we go. Okay, you see what happened? So these guys, these guys are technically like disabled and hidden everything. They're like not processing, but the leader is still there. Now, if anybody comes close to them, if it's a player, for example, if a player comes close, they'll all reappear. And they'll carry on functioning. This shouldn't actually break scripts really. It did move them to their positions, but they'll fix themselves. It's generally fine. It's generally safe for like these guys, I think. It doesn't break garrisoning, so it's actually fine. And then
Soldier, 300 meters east.
And then they also, if you have a blue another AI group that happens to attack them,
we'll go.
Then you'll see them pop in. And there we go. So you can actually have in the ZB system to still work. Okay, so that's the one caching system.
Yeah. That is very useful.
Yeah, so that one's generally safe to use, actually. So you can actually, this one I recommend you try first. And then another system that I use a lot, and it actually requires a scripting snippet, but I'll just show you one thing, just how it looks like, is... Let me place two enemies. I need to delete the ZBE system to actually so you can see it. I'm going to place two squads here and here. And these guys are going to have what's called dynamic simulation. So dynamic simulation is a Bohemian Interactive built-in thing. So this is the kind of caching sort of system. Now these that they actually want you to use. If I go to, you can actually set the settings of them somewhere. Animations, config, functions, debug console, attributes, performance. Yeah, performance attributes to performance. The dynamic simulation. So you can set how the distances that they work and all that stuff. But basically, what it is a disabled simulation. So if you remember with those buildings, like those buildings, Heskard barriers, bases are disabled simulation. It's basically that. Yeah. Until someone comes close and then re-enable simulation. So I'll show you what it looks like now. Okay, so let's go to those guys. So you will see these guys have weapons low. They look natural just standing there. These guys still have the weapons raised because they haven't even started yet. So like if I were to give a waypoint to these guys, these guys will not move because these are all disabled. So they're not actually consuming like no server resources. Only when you come close by do they then work? So I teleport, and I'm over here. That's why I'm. Yeah.
What's your position?
So, yeah. But there are some downsides. If I teleport away, okay, they're disabled again. There you go. You see, they're just frozen in mid.
Oh, okay.
My game has not frozen. They've frozen. If I were to spawn, let's say, a blue 4 group that does not have dynamic simulation enabled, it's AI.
Ready.
Okay, it does actually. So in that sense, that works well. But the downside is that you can't have them move waypoints. Like these guys, because ZB is disabled. When the ZB was working, these guys are still able to move around patrol when they're disabled.
Those guys
are frozen in place. So they can't do anything.
That's kind of stupid. I like the NR6 one more.
Yeah, it works more out of the box. Before we had NR6, and I do actually still use it. If it's a QRF that no one needs to see, then the table simulation is fine. If you're just supposed to stand in the place until something happens, then it's fine. The way I actually use this, I'll just show you. I won't actually implement it, but I'll just show you how to find it. So if I go to, it's actually more of a bunch of stuff you can use. It's about like a long term, like if you want more fancy QRFs that can reliably wait for a long, like attack at a certain time of day and stuff. Then stuff like that. Wait, so is it trigger override and long-term triggers, QF transports? Hold on. It is automated AI sleepy trigger. There we go. So triggered reinforcements attackers with direct simulation. So basically, I have a system where we put some small script snippets here and there. And then when a trigger is activated, it'll actually disable the simulation dynamic simulation system for those guys, and they'll be re-enabled. So you have advantages of them being disabled, so they won't take any resources. But when a trigger is activated, then they'll move out. So if you look from a distance, so ZBE, one downside of ZBE caching, if you have like really fancy optics, like you can see 2 kilometers away, you'll see one guy patrolling around. They say, "Hey, that's just one guy." Then you say, "Okay, let's kill that one guy." Everyone moves in, and suddenly 50 AI spawn in because they were ZBE cached, like you actually saw just now. So that's one downside. The advantage of the dynamic simulation system that I like to use is that you'll see all the AI there. They're disabled, they don't affect any server resources, and you will still see them. So the intelligence can see that there's actually enemies over there. And then when you come close to them, they'll wake up and kill you. And if you go and attack the objective in their QRF, then they'll go, and thanks to these scripting snippets over here, they will then go and
counterattack. Cool. Yeah.
So that's how I always use dynamic simulations. I actually use it quite frequently, and I only use it like this with this thing over here.
Yeah, that's useful. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's pretty much everything. So do you guys have any missions that you'd like me to upload to the server?
Hang on a little bit. Do a bit of finishing.
I lost my mouse, man.
Okay, so I'll just sit here for actually, you know what I'll do? I'll just have something. I'll probably eat something in the background, and I'll stay on here for like another 20-15 minutes. If you have any questions, I'll answer them, and then we can upload. And I think this is officially like the end of the thing. So if you guys want to go, then that's probably fine. And then I'll just hang around if you have any questions or want to finish off your missions.
I'll drop you a message as I have questions, but I first need to go and sit and play around, and it's going to take some time.
I'll upload this as soon as I'm done here. I'll upload. Let me just check that OBS is actually working.
Where will you upload the video, though? Because I guess it's quite big.
YouTube is so forgiving. It is a 4K 60fps video, and YouTube will be like, why the fuck are you doing this to me? Like, because I can.
Phoenix?
Yeah?
Quick question. Well, basically, in the beginning, right?
In the beginning.
That's
we placed, we placed okay. our friendly units, right? In the base.
Yeah.
How do you designate those units for players instead of the game putting in AI?
So what you do is you just I did hint at earlier. So if you have a bunch of AI, let me just place here. You make them playable over here.
Yeah. Oh.
And now it'll show up in the slot selection. So we actually see with slot selection if we play.
Because I'm asking if I go on my game now into play scenario. Our friendly units becomes AI.
Yes. So that's single player. So let me actually show you. So if you just say play as character. So there's actually three modes. It's three environments the mission can run in. There's single player, which is what we're doing right now, and we'll be doing the entire thing in the Eden Editor. There's multiplayer, where it's in a multiplayer mode, but the mission is running on one of the players, so computers. That's the person hosting the mission. And then it's dedicated, where the mission, where the server is not running on anyone's computers. It's a separate computer. So here we are. These are AI slots. Xampf actually does some fancy things. Xampf actually disables all these AI. So you can actually see them. They just stand in formation. They don't do anything. They won't do anything otherwise.
Yeah, on my screen, on my game, they start running around.
Okay, then they probably don't have the Xampf loaded in correctly. But before, I'll show you how to fix it. First, and if we go to play multiplayer, so you just click OK. So this one you can actually host on your machine. Other people can join you. If you go to slots, you'll see the slots and the new guy I placed over here. Team leader, this is the guy I placed, the new guy over here. Now if we play. So this is where we're running in multiplayer mode, but the server is running on my computer, on one of the player's machines. And the third one, dedicated, is when it's running on a server that's not anyone's player machine. So there's three environments you have to know about. Single player, multiplayer, dedicated. And the what's nice about testing it in multiplayer mode is that it follows the same kind of flow as a mission. So I'll go to the map screen first, you can see what it looks like. And then when you go inside, you'll see no one's here. So the Xampf makes sure that no one is spawned in if they're supposed to be playable. So that's why you won't get AI running around your group. Okay, now if you have the issue where you have them running around, the Xampf is probably not running correctly. So you just need to make sure that inside your mission folder, op test, you have it looks like this. You have your mission.sqm. Which is what the mission Eden Editor creates, and everything else inside the Orbat, pre-init, this and that, Xampf folder. Don't confuse, there's two Xampf. There's a Xampf, which is a repo with a Xampf VR inside of it. And inside of Xampf VR, there's another Xampf folder. This actually contains the core framework logic. So you want to make sure that Xampf, which has stuff like this, like functions and res and AI or whatever. And then looks like that.
Okay.
So if you have that, then everything should work. If not, just let me know.
Okay, cool.
Cool. So that's the thing I want to show over there. Okay, so should I hang around for a bit?
You know what? if you just sent the link to the video once you've uploaded it, I would first like to watch it again, and then I'll try to start building a mission, and I'll drop you messages then as I have questions and stuff.
Cool. Anybody else?
No, not for me. I've got a mission, but it's very rough.
I think we're all just going to play a bit, see what works, what doesn't work. And if we eat the snack, we'll talk to you.
Cool. Felix, can you also put the mission file somewhere?
My mission file thing.
Yeah. No, just to, in case we want to see some of your triggers and just see.
Sure. So what I'll do is, let me just think, make sure it's cleaned up. I think I'll put ZB. It makes a lot of sense for ZB to be in here. So that's pretty much the mission. If I were to re-upload again, by the way, I would go here. I would increment by one. Let's save. I would export multiplayer. Then I would go into the thing that's exported. You'll see the mission. It generates another mission file that looks like this. And I do 1001. So minor changes are one. New features of that. If you completely rebuild a mission from scratch, then the first let number increments. It's not too important you know that, but I'm just showing you.
It's just your version and revision.
Let me just do that. So I'm just going to tweak the channels around. So the scripting snippets. Do you guys have access to scripting snippets in Discord now?
I haven't tried.
Have a look.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna make a new channel just for what should I call it? Basically, I want to onboarding mission makers or something like onboarding missions.
Mission baking makers noobs.
Well, because we see this is all the offices in ZA. We already have a missions office over here, so I don't want to confuse it with that one. Because any of you can join the missions office if you want to make missions for ZA, then you can join it, and there's some extra resources over there. It's a lot of people here, so I don't know if it makes sense for everyone to join the missions office and get spoiled information in the missions channel.
We just call it forum for mission makers.
Mission ideas, I guess, is good enough.
You know what? We have mission ideas. Fine. We'll use that one. Mission ideas. We already have. It's not used for anything else, really. Okay. So inside here, I will go ahead and zip up the mission. Where is it now? It probably doesn't matter. There we go. So that's my mission is in a zip file right over there. So you can use it. I'll post a link inside here for the YouTube when I get a link. But it'll take a while to process. It'll take a long time to process, actually.
Thank you.
Cool. Okay. So yeah. Anything else? Any of you guys want to ask anything?
No. Just thank you. Thank you for the effort. It gives us a new appreciation for the mission makers currently and what goes into it. So.
Yeah. From my side, also.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah.
I have a question, a bit off topic. Ben quite always struggle to make a server, but it's got to do with the port 14 thing. So I don't know. Can it be our internet providers actually blocking us?
No, your routers.
In my experience, it's really just some configuration thing. I mean, some other random Armor community, South African one that I've never heard of before, poked me like midnight one night and, hey, can you help us with this? Like, fine. And I just helped them sort out some port issues. It just had some weird configurations. So it's just port stuff. I could help with that, but not now.
Yeah,
it's very difficult. The other thing also you can do, because I've probably spent days with this with a friend of mine, Shane. It's been so long. The only thing that really worked for us was to use Radman. It's a program called Radman, which is like a, what do they call it? It's kind of like a
VPN.
It kind of fools your it kind of fools your VPN. Oh. Kind of fools computers in different areas to think it's a local network, and that's the only thing that worked. And I think to disable my firewall and DMZ and all that stuff, and then to also
Yeah, so what I recommend then, guys, because you're all ZA members, it's not something too secret. If it's a mission, it doesn't even have to follow our normal mission spec. It'd be crazy stuff because as long as it's not supposed to be played as a true, like an official mission, there's not really much in the way of rules. You can do whatever you want. So if it uses our mod line, then just I can upload on the server for you. You can play with them. Because just let me know in terms of SOP, which is not, it used to be like in their website, but now that page is gone, so I have to put it back up. Any ZA members, like the highest ranking ZA members on the server, are in charge and can do whatever they want with the server. So you can, if it's an off night and you're a ZA member, you can invite as many random players on the server as you want, and you are in charge. So you can have your I can upload the mission for you, and then you can bring your players on and you can play on it. As long as the ZA member is playing. So if you leave and it's only random people playing on our server, then I'll probably just kick them off or something. But as long as the ZA member is there, it's fine.
Okay. Cool. And how do we send you, or how do we give you the mission?
So the thing I want is the PBO file. So in the MP missions folder, the PBO I told you about, just give me, it has to be, have yeah. a PBO extension. So give me that one and I'll just upload it.
Okay. That's...
Okay, guys, I'm going to say goodbye. Thank you, Phoenix. Oh, much appreciated.
Thanks, guys.
Appreciate it. Cool.
My head is now over full, so I have to go process. Cool. Cheers.
All right. Cheers, everyone. Bye. Oh, you're
cheers.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Phoenix. It helped a lot.
No problem. Bye. User disconnected from your channel.